How is it that someone from the 14th century in the cave in Tibet would write all these great amount of writings, and then someone hanging out in suburbia of San Francisco Bay Area in the 21st century, how is it that I can find nothing that I disagree with at all in what's being said and what's being written? And that I clearly recognize it and resonate with it, and there's no difficulty with it, and there's agreement with it. How is that? You start to ask this question. How is that possible? How is it possible? Isn't it possible because there's a common reference point, a common theme being pointed to that transcends location and culture and epochs, and all this transcends time, space, process, and form? And it's like I can say, I see what you're pointing to. I recognize the pointing. Very clear pointing towards something. How else is it possible? If conditioning is so important, if environment is so important, if our educational system is so important, how is it that I can clearly resonate and appreciate, and I can't find anything that I disagree with in what Longchenpa has written? How is it that this is possible? Did we have the same education, the same culture, the same environment, the same nurturance, the same books, the same anything? No, everything was extraordinarily different. So explain that. Let's have the materialists take the floor and explain it. And the more I read of Longchenpa, the more astonishing it is. It's just like, wow. It's like I'm listening to myself. But where does this come from? Maybe it comes from a common self. Maybe it comes from a common self. More evidence of the falsity of materialism. The belief in compounded existence. The worshipping of time, space, process, and form, which leads to all sorts of conclusions that are not fact, that are refuted, that cannot be truly substantiated based on all the evidence that they sweep under the rug so much that you can't even walk on the rug. So much has been swept under the rug. Shoo-bop, shoo-be-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-be-doo-bop, shoo-bop, I can't recall the first time. Yeah! Keep in mind that all these trends, there's so many trends, okay, really new trends are recycled trends, but powerful trends in the world. And these trends are converging. This is what I'm talking about. People are looking at separate trends. They see this separate, they see this separate, they see this separate, and say, what's the problem? They don't see the convergence that's happening. They're not aware of the convergence. They're refusing to be aware of the convergence. It's the convergence of trends. Just like storms are the convergence of different pressure systems. Are different attributes converge. Moisture content, a lot of stuff that goes into a storm. So it's convergence that we're looking at, and the speed of convergence. And when trends are converging, the speed speeds up, and it can become exponentially quick. This is why the Holy Spirit is warning us about July of this year, July 24th. So many trends are converging, and like a falling into a black hole, they tend to accentuate each other and pull each other together. So we're going along, ignorance is bliss, we think. I've just been struggling with the Bluetooth here, always struggling. I mean, I hate it. You know, and it's funny because technology reflects the mind belief system of those who make it. And like all of us here who believe in compounded existence, which means we're trying to make time real to what? Support absurdity. So to say that absurdity is true. Okay, believing in time is an absurdity. Trying to make time real is trying to make absurdity true and reality absurdity. This is what we're trying to do out of our own this arrogance and adventurousness of trying to change reality. We thought, hey, let's see what our mind can do. Let's find the boundaries of it. Well, we cannot change reality. So what we do with our continuity fear, all this is just a dance of continuity fear. We're afraid to stop this effort to make time real. This is all a pretense. We're afraid to drop the pretense, so we keep pretending that all this is, that our perception is really showing us the truth. Sensory perception. What we do is on the surface, what the ego does, egoic consciousness, which is this dance of continuity fear, actually, it pretends to be pro-truth, pro whatever the Holy Spirit says, it pretends to be pro that. Oh yeah, I'm pro that. Of course I'm pro that. And then on the other hand, it sabotages the momentum in that direction. Sabotages it. And it's amazing how this shows up in technology. Because technology gets this, all this promise. Oh sure, this will do this and this and this. It's so great. And yet, on the other hand, there's all these troubles that keep sabotaging the smoothness of it all. This is what I've experienced. I call it chasing the dragon. Technology is this dragon, and we're chasing it. And it keeps luring us more and more and more. Where? To where? At some point, deeper questions have to be asked about the mentality of those who have developed this technology. This is what I've looked into after chasing. You know, it's just, oh, this will fix it. 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 No problem. This will fix it. No problem. Get this. Get no problem. I said, wait a minute. I think we've had technology now around long enough to question it. Deeply question the mentality of those who are presenting this to us. And is it not a facade camouflaging sabotage? And the Bluetooth is a perfect example. I mean, when it works, you say, oh, great, it works. But how many times does it not work? How many problems of incompatibility have I had? How many different Bluetooth devices have I gone through? It's always buy something new. Oh, you need some fix. Get an IT help. You know, struggle. How come the phone connects? One day everything's working fine, the next day it won't work. Why? Why? You know, what's the explanation? What's the clear explanation? There's never a real clear explanation except, well, you know, there's a bug here, some compatibility, need to upgrade this, and it just keep, and need to sell you more stuff. Need to keep investing, weld yourself to it, weld yourself to it. We're getting welded to technology. And what we're really getting welded to is a belief system. What's the belief system of those who have invented this technology? This is what's important because it will reflect their belief system, just like software reflects the belief system of those who make and program the software. And the idea is that somehow these people are just pure and free and clear, and everything is perfect with this technology is not being supported by the facts at all. Never has. Never has. People complained about like Windows from the very beginning. They said that Bill Gates, you know, is the severe criticism of his mentality of look what he did, look at the difficulties and all this is horrible, horrible. That so many people hated that and hated like Bill Gates, for example. Oh boy, Microsoft was just the devil because it reflected his mentality, his belief system, and the people that he pulled around him reflected his belief system. Right? It's the same with all these people, all these minds, all this technology. Everything is a reflection of our belief system. It's a dance of continuity fear, and continuity fear dances. The way it dances is it flirts with truth and then sabotages that flirtation. And then makes it feel powerful. So how can absurdity feel powerful except to think that it can conquer truth and reality? So first it has to set reality up, and then it crushes it. It crushes its interest. It builds up interest, then it crushes it. It sabotages it. So it's this sabotage we need to be aware of. And I've noticed this is something that psychoanalytics has noticed. They couldn't put it in the right context at all, but they're sort of like in a materialistic way, they're just noticing this evidence keeps showing up. They don't know really what it points to, but here we know what it points to very much so. So all this convergence that's happening with all this technology is really a convergence of trends which reflect a simply belief system. And we know it's an egoic belief system. It's absolutely full of sabotage. It's a dance of continuity fear. And the way that continuity fear dances, it sets you up to knock you down. Okay, it sets truth up to knock it down. This is how absurdity works. So I would say the evidence is that it's absurdity based. I would say you have to lean, the evidence points very strongly in that direction enough to have a theory about it. And if you have a theory, you have a right to accept that theory, okay, until something else truly comes along and shows differently. But this theory has been around for a long, long time. It's just the continuity fear keeps trying to dismiss it. This modern culture is very dismissive, and which is of truth, of time-tested truth, a time-tested theory about what's going on here. And these trends that are happening in the world right now are extraordinarily dismissive of this theory, this very, very solid theory that these great teachers and their great students throughout history have discovered through tremendous efforts on their part and have tested it out to a huge extent. So this theory is supported by all this testing and the evidence. And the fact that continuity fear is just dismissing it through a bunch of totally bogus excuses and glamours, in no way does that make the theory untrue or dismisses it at all. Not at all. But these trends that are coming, that are converging, not coming like all arriving in separate areas, they're all converging, reinforcing one another, are trends of dismissal of this beautiful theory about what is really fact. Extremely dismissive of it. This is why the Holy Spirit has been sounding the alarm to me, sounding the alarm relentlessly, is this convergence of these dismissive trends, each one reinforcing one another, the sum greater than the parts. The ultimate outcome is greater than the sum of the parts. Okay, the potency of this dismissal is much greater than the sum of the parts. So we cannot spend our time trying to total up the sum of the parts. And this is what I'm trying to get out there to everyone. We must not spend our time trying to total up the sum of the parts, tracing this part and this part. Okay, what's the total? Let's total it up. No. The overall impact, it will be much, much greater than the mere sum of the parts. Much, much, much greater. And this is, so we must not get trapped in this trying to sum it up, to figure it out in this way. This is what I call too much trouble, too much trouble. So we cannot get caught in this trap of trying to total it up. We must have sub faith in the Holy Spirit, because our theory supports this, that the Holy Spirit is aware of the impact of it and the force of this dismissal. And the Holy Spirit is saying it is extremely dismissive, to the point where we've been warned in Scripture where even the saints will be in danger of apostasy and backsliding, losing their true perception. That is how strong the dismissal is. That is about to smash us. So let us not get caught with trying to total up the sum of the parts. This is the huge, huge dangerous mistake that we must avoid. All important. So we must avoid analysis of it at this point. At some point you say, hey, wait a minute. This is going to be so severe that I don't dare keep trying to analyze it, because I'll get caught in it then. It's like a flood trying to analyze the floodwaters, and at some point, you get caught up in the floodwaters. It's very simple. For those who have not repented, which means to look at the premise. Repent means to look at the premise. For those who are not willing to look at the premise, the sabotage outweighs any progress. So you're going in reverse. It's like someone trying to swim upstream. They're not swimming strong enough. So look at how fast, look at they're swimming, wow. But actually, the current is taking them downstream. Where someone who's repented, the velocity and intensity of their efforts are such that they're literally swimming upstream. They're actually making progress upstream. This is a way of looking at it. And the more progress they make upstream, the current seems to be less and less, and they get stronger and stronger, and so they go faster and faster. So repentance is a path of success. You actually go faster and faster and faster, which is why you have to manage your success on the spiritual path, because the success gets greater and greater and greater and greater and greater. It's interesting. Why do so many people have dogs constantly with them now? You could, especially the yoga girls. Well, it used to be that women would doll themselves up and say, look how cute and cuddly I am, trying to hide their sabotaging, unrepentant sabotaging mindset, belief system, those who are unrepentant. Now, they're so aggressive and tough, and they don't seem cute and cuddly at all, really. And so they have these cute, cuddly dogs with them as a defense, saying, look how cute and cuddly my dog is, and by extension, I am. You got it? When you really repent, you find out you don't really need animals around. Don't really need animals around. Animals can be helpful if you've repented. You may have one that helps you, pushes you in some way. Like a cat, that I had was just, you know, just absolutely so blissed out. It was just amazing. And it put us all to shame, put me to shame. I said, oh my God, you know, this it's just natural, this natural blissed outness. And so I use that to push me myself and say, wow, I have to keep working. I'm not, this is a goal. To have this just this wonderful, Buddha mind, central part of the five family qualities of just this complete blissed out acceptance of all. But in general, as far as a social trend, you can look at the world and see and just say, wow. And you see, if people meet each other, they really relate to each other through their animals. And say, look what a great animal I am. Look what a friendly animal I am. But we're not animals. To say that we're animals is part of the sabotage. It is very strong part of the sabotage. Anyone who says I'm a human being has the sabotaging part of their belief system of the continuity fear is in control. I never say I'm a human being or I'm a person. It's figure of speech we might be talking, but I'm not a human being. I'm not a person. I didn't evolve from apes. I wasn't born of a woman. None of that. I'm spirit. I'm spirit. I'm spirit. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. And so here, right there, walking by, there's a yoga girl and a fluffy little white poodle, a miniature fluffed out. I mean, oh my gosh, sort of like a Yorkshire, I don't know what the combination is there. But that was the perfect cuddly, poodly dog. Perfect. And there's another yoga girl pushing her twins. It ready. That dog, white, fluffy white, just want to come and say, oh, you're so fluffy and so cuddly and so wonderful. Okay. That's how, see, this becomes the alter ego. And then by extension, you think that the person, the spirit with the belief system you're dealing with is also that way. And so it's a camouflage. It's a deception. It's a deception. It helps to sabotage. It absolutely helps sabotage. You never hear it historically, almost never, those who are truly repentant emphasizing animals and pets and living with animals and pets. No, absolutely not. Now, to reiterate, to go over once again, these trends, converging trends, the impact will be greater than the sum of the parts. Therefore, let us not get trapped in trying to detail the parts so that we can add up and come up with a sum and then assess the impact of it. This is what the Holy Spirit is warning me about. I'm trying to warn everyone about, and I'm getting there. Do not try to keep assessing the various parts of it. Not too much. We're talking about what's the overall goal? To dismiss. The overall goal is to dismiss. To sabotage through dismissal. The tremendous theory of reality that all those who have realized and been aware of reality have told us about, that these are the true facts, is to dismiss the true facts. And there's no question in my mind that I have observed these trends, not figured them, not calculated them, just been aware of these trends. It's very important to not try and catalog. Don't get caught up in cataloging and dissecting and all this. Because the more important question is, well, these trends I'm observing, are they converging? And what does this reflect? And what does this mean? And what precautions should I take? And how bad is it really going to be? Those are the more important questions. And the tremendous dismissal of the real true facts by all these modern trends is a red flag, if ever there was a red flag. So we turn to the Holy Spirit and say, okay, get us out of harm's way. Talk the talk, good. Now let's walk the walk. So our scientific assessment is it's simply an attempt to sabotage and dismiss facts and truth. Facts and truth can never be dismissed except through pretension. It doesn't touch the facts or truth at all, really. So what we say is just simply, we have assessed it properly. We assess it as too much trouble, meaning it's best to sidestep it so we're not tempted to measure and calculate it. Clever, clever sabotage should be sidestepped. So we could just say, I don't know what happened in terms of bits and pieces and parts. I know what the whole purpose of it is. I know, and I don't know the full intensity, but later on I will. Later on, when I'm truly free of any danger, then I can, if necessary, give an objective assessment of the intensity. But it has no intensity at all in regard to truth, in terms of changing truth, zero. So that's what's important. In other words, the ultimate assessment of it is it's a total failure. But because of all the efforts and involvement and the collective efforts, it's very difficult to recognize it's a total failure. And so we're in great danger of thinking, well, we've got to give it some credence just to keep functioning here. Just to feel like, wow, we're not total morons, you know. Well, we're trying to be, but we're not really. So we'll give it some credence, but this is a very dangerous thing. So, like, for instance, just ignore the election in the United States or wherever you're living. Just ignore it. For me, I don't care. I don't even know who's running at this point. I don't care who's running. It makes no difference whatsoever, because these trends in the world are way more powerful and important than any figurehead or political figure. Way more important. They're going to converge no matter what. Doesn't matter who's elected. The trends are still going to converge. So I won't pay any attention to the election. I won't even know who's president. I mean, obviously it'll filter through to me, but it doesn't matter at all. It's just a diversion, a red herring. These trends are still going to converge, and they're going to be too much trouble. So why even be appraised of this part of history? We already know what it's about. The little details are distractions, actually. So we already know what the Holy Spirit knows what this part of history is about. So we will get a history lesson from the Holy Spirit. Okay? So we're not going to be ignorant of this part of history, but we're going to get a true assessment of this part of history. And it's better not to be involved with it in order to get a true assessment from the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit knows everything and has a perfect assessment of all. And the Holy Spirit is within our mind. God created it within our mind as a blessing upon our mind. So we all have access to this perfect assessment capability. If the facts spiritual truth are true, then the facts of materialism are not true. You can't have them both true, actually. True, as Jesus says over and over, truth and lies cannot be both true. Truth and lies cannot both be true. This is like at the heart of our confusion, and Jesus knows what the heart of our confusion is and what's important to focus on. And, you know, to use, like, for instance, the evangelicals as a yardstick for religion is ridiculous. That's heavily sabotaging true religion. Not all of it. I mean, some of it's good, but a lot of it there is, though, are those who are not, I would say, not strongly repentant. They may be in the early phases of repentance, and they sort of got this euphoria, but they're also clinging to a lot of Old Testament legalism. All right, it's a mixed bag. It's a mixed bag. I mean, I don't condemn the evangelicals at all. A lot of what they do has helpful parts, but there's a mixture there of help and sabotage going on. And so what happens is the materialist sees upon this and say, look what a bunch of, you know, knuckleheads they are. Look what they're doing. They're handling snakes and all this, you know, oh, they're crazy. And this, you know, they try to demonize all religion in this way. Now, we're not fooled by that, but there's enormous pressure to silence all religion and dismiss it because of some, you know, maybe overzealousness and just, you know, over-emotionalism, various factors. Certainly, the idea of an angry, punishing, threatening God that we must, you know, have a sacrifice to appease this God, that God can eat the flesh of this sacrifice and this will satisfy God's bloodlust and all that, you know, this stuff. Of course, none of that is true. So, and yet, there is some repentance there. There is some repentance. It's just volatile. And there's a lot of sabotage going on also there. It's not smoothed out smoothness. Okay. So it's a rugged, ragged road. But materialists seize upon that and want to dismiss all of it. They want to dismiss all of it. They say, well, it's got to be blemish-free, or else it's all false. But keep in mind, truth is blemish-free. But our dance of continuity fear is what's really taking place. And as long as that continuity fear is there, it's going to pretend as though there are blemishes upon truth. So the materialists don't have any way to measure it accurately at all. They're extraordinarily ignorant. That's what they want. That's their goal, is to dismiss truth, to be ignorant of it. So they are in no way, do they know really anything? Can they even speak in any wise way whatsoever upon truth? They haven't investigated it at all. Whatever pseudo-investigations they do are utterly shoddy. Ridiculously shoddy. Merely sorting through whatever evidence to find something that supports their position, but in the larger context, you know, they're just ignoring the real evidence, the real facts. Out of continuity fear, they don't want to see it. They don't want to see it. It's too easy. This is this easiness, this simplicity, this simple shift is what frightens us all. See, truth can never stop being true. So, truth is always entirely simple. It's simply true. And it's always true. So it's always present for us. And all we can just see it, and it's already simple. There's no continuity fear issue with truth at all. We're assuming that there is, and we project it upon truth, and therefore we feel this continuity fear, and we need to evaporate it But what I'm saying is we evaporate it, we thin it out. Thin it out, thin it out, thin it out. And so we can more and more see that, hey, truth doesn't have any continuity fear within it. It never abandons itself. There's no need to get back to it. It doesn't lose itself. It does. So there can't arise any continuity fear within truth. So when we shift and perceive from the standpoint of truth, we're already free of continuity fear. And there's nothing we need to do to stay free of it, except abide in the awareness of truth, in the awareness of awareness. Intermittent clouds and sunshine today after a lot of rain yesterday. A little cooler. Cherry blossoms everywhere. Blossoms on the trees. Beautiful. Green hills everywhere. Spring is going full blast, actually. Weeds are growing like crazy. So, it's a Friday here, and yet the grasses are growing, and yet in the world there's all these trends that are about to converge. Now, we might say materialistically, well, we don't know what's going to happen. We have to stay here to assess it. Really? All the trends are designed to dismiss truth. What more do we need to assess? The only question is how intense is this dismissal going to be? But is that the pertinent question? Or is the pertinent question, what's the purpose? Oh, the purpose is to dismiss truth. This is something I want to sidestep then. That's all we need to know. If we know that these trends are potent, we know they're being pushed to the utmost, we know there's a fanatical effort to make this the law of the land. We know all of this already. So measuring the exact magnitude, it is what the least of our concerns. That's the least of our concerns. It's like saying, well, the earthquake is at a 9.9 or a 9.99 earthquake, you know. Hey, it's a devastating earthquake. If you were in a city and you knew like a 9.9 something was coming to your city, wouldn't you get out of the city? Or would you stay there and say, well, I can't go because I need to assess whether it's a 9.9 or 9.92. I got to be a scientist. No, that's not a scientist. It's not a scientist at all. That's a materialist who's simply hoping that it will be severe enough to dismiss truth from their minds. And we're saying, well, yeah, it's going to be severe enough. The Holy Spirit says it's going to be severe enough to delay the recognition of truth in our minds if we subject ourselves to it. Truth never leaves our minds, but we can delay our awareness of it. Well, certainly very severe. So whether the dismissal is a 9.1 or a 9.2 dismissal, it's still an incredibly severe dismissal, strong enough to push us into another cycle. It's like, you know, like an earthquake's a 9 point something. Well, that's strong enough to do major infrastructure damage, okay? And very different than like a 6 point something. So we just need these echelons is all we really need to know in terms of basic decisions. Do you leave the city or not? I mean, do you make, you know, provisions? If it's something that's going to flatten the city, it's so severe, yeah, then it doesn't matter. You know, if the city's flattened, why does it matter whether it's a 9.2 or a 9.5 or something? If the end result is that the city's still flattened, a 9.2 will flatten it, then 9.5 will flatten it. 9.5, I mean, if a building collapses, it collapses. It doesn't matter how much overkill you're used. You know, if you're demoing a building and you use enough explosive to demo it, then why does it matter if there's extra there? It doesn't really matter, does it? It's like beating a dead horse. which we don't want to do, right? But I mean, it's just, you know, so how much overkill will there be is basically what the question is. And is that really that important to us? How much overkill will there be? No. This is just sort of tabloid, you know, mentality. Like we have to wallow in the shock of it or something. No. That is just for those who have this attitude are just hoping it will completely dismiss truth from their minds. And so they're saying, well, this is important. This is important we assess this. But they're really saying it's important we remain here so we knock truth completely out of our minds. That's what they're really saying. I just drove out into a field. Yeah, I did. That's okay. Now I'm back on the road. What's important right now is to keep alive, focus on truth as much as possible, as many as possible, so that there will be many to help out, more to help out, because so many are going into a very fragmented dismissal of truth state of mind, belief system, very fragmented, where they think that everybody's different. No, everybody's actually the same. Everybody has the same mind, actually. Everybody has the same access to the one mind. There's just one mind. There are not all many different minds. This is not true. There are many different pretend minds. There's many different pretensions, denials. There are many different styles of denial. But there's only one mind. Meaning one perfect responsiveness to what we want to experience. So we're all exactly the same, actually. Not all different. And we all seem to have different lives. But this is just a dance of continuity fear, actually, that we're experiencing. And we all have freedom to experience what we want. But the freedom is the same. The mind is the same. The functionality of reality is exactly the same for everyone. And this is what this is part of what's being dismissed. The whole clarity about reality is set to be dismissed here in this world. So we want as many as possible to reinforce. And so I say go to a reduced intensity zone, those who are focused on truth, who are truly repentant, and reinforce it and become super, super, super clear about it, perfectly clear about it. So then there could be a massive effort later on to help out those who are really just floundering. And it's better to work on assessing getting perfectly clear than it is to try to assess, well, how badly are they floundering? It's kind of like saying a city's in rubble, and we're saying, well, how bad is the rubble? Well, a new building's got to be built. You know, it doesn't matter. You clear the rubble out. Let's say there's block buildings, and it's completely rubble. All right. Well, does it matter how many fragments the stones have broken into? No. You get a bulldozer with a loader, and you load the rubble in a truck, and you take it out of there. Same volume of rubble. Doesn't matter how many pieces the concrete broke into, you know, when it collapsed or something. It doesn't really matter. Why is that relevant? That's an extreme irrelevancy. But this is the distraction that minds of quantification are obsessed with. They think the answer is just more quantification. Let's count the pieces of rubble. Let's count the grains of sand. Instead of clearing it out, they count it. They're saying, well, we can't clear it out until we count it. Well, what do you mean? You can't clear it out until you count it. Is that who? What kind of law is there that you can't clear it out, the rubble out, until you count all the grains, pieces and grains of sand? This is the bizarre nature of materialistic mind. That in confusion, they believe that refuge from confusion comes from counting. why they try to teach you when you're young, when you get panicky, they say, just start counting. 1, 2, 3, 4. Like, count stuff. Oh, that. Well, that just pulls you. The confusion is that you're trying to dismiss reality. And then they say the remedy is to dismiss it even more. Because the panic is indecision. You're thinking, like, which way should I go? I'm not sure. And they say, well, go the way of materialism, and then you won't have the panic. Well, yeah, but you will have the continuity fear. So out of the frying pan and into the fire with this bad advice. So there are these key pressure points, spiritual pressure points, as it were, that the ego uses, and we have to be clear about those. And so the hurdles you have to clear. So it's the importance in clearing these hurdles, not counting the grains of sand. So those who want to help out cannot get caught up in the falsity of too much accounting, but rather they have to be able to remain clear about what the hurdles are. It's all leveraged, and the Holy Spirit, and have to be rely upon the Holy Spirit with its great perfect assessment. Which understands how to weight everything in terms of leverage. So the Holy Spirit has had the perfect goal, perfection, perfectly in awareness, and therefore knows how to leverage everything perfectly. Whereas mere counting doesn't give you any clarity about how to leverage towards a goal, the true goal, at all. It's just like, you know, foolish. It's a foolish absurdity. Say, well, I've counted this much, and I know how many grains of sand are. What does that have to do with truly knowing how to clear it out, real fast, and get the leverage to do that? It gives a false sense of confidence, is what it does. So we certainly don't want to entertain a false sense of confidence. This is the worst thing to do. This is what this culture is bringing us towards, is a false sense of confidence. In the ability to just count, calculate. Computers, calculation. Calculate everything. And then regulate based on all this calculation. This is a false sense of confidence. Because we don't know what the goal is, actually. The Holy Spirit knows what the goal is, so it gives us a true sense of confidence. Having a false goal of absurdity and feeling confident you can make absurdity real is false confidence. False confidence. And this is what the music is all about. You know, the song, I still remember the first time I saw you walking by. Shoo-bop, shoo-be-doo-bop, shoo-bop. It's talking to the audience and say, hey, remember when you first fell in love, that first look, and you thought, this is the one. And so people like to go back to that and say, oh, yeah. Because what it really is a special relationship is designed to build up false confidence. And so false confidence doesn't work. And so after a while, we start feeling like, wow, I don't really feel as confident as I used to feel. What's going on? And so the songs say, hey, don't you remember the first time, you know, you saw each other, how confident you felt then? But the confidence was like, hey, maybe false confidence really can work. So this is what we call love here in this world. Romantic love, special love relationship, is you think, oh, false confidence can work. And then we find out it doesn't later on. Then we go listen to these songs trying to recapture that magic, we call it the magic we used to feel. The magic, a magical belief that false confidence will satisfy us. So all these songs, it's just amazing. If you know music, and especially like pop music, the themes, it's just astonishing. You listen to it, you go back in hindsight and say, what was I listening to? I mean, it's so blatant. It's like, It's like, was I insane? I actually listened to this? I mean, these are the words? This is what it was telling me? Oh my gosh. But yeah, it's just all about this romance, and trying to bring back that magic, you know, because so people are suckers for it. Absolute suckers for it. Because they don't know any better. They say, what happened to my confidence? They think that you get confidence through the special relationship. You don't. You get false confidence through the special relationship. And false confidence isn't confidence. And you know it. And you feel it. And so you say, wow, what's gone wrong? Love's gone wrong. I listen to a song and maybe that'll inspire me. I've got to be more inspired. I feel so uninspired now in this special relationship. There are so many minds in this world now who are addicted to false confidence and the calculation that is central to false confidence, that it's a very, very, very dangerous situation for those who don't want to get pulled into false confidence. Very dangerous situation. And the converging trends, as they all converge, it's exponentially potent. Exponentially potent. It's like a catalyst. You see, we put it, I used to work with resin and you put catalyst in the resin. And this is what makes the resin crystallize or harden up. And so you don't need much catalyst. You don't need much at all. You just put in a few drops, and that somehow catalyzes a reaction. It's the same thing in the world. Is potency of reaction can be catalyzed. You put enough catalyst in, and you can cause a tremendous amount of reaction. Tremendous. So when you have a convergence of various catalytic trends, then you have to believe and have a heads up and say, you know, this just scientifically, you know, this is going to create a tremendous reaction. A crystallizing of magical belief, of false confidence. And this is something you want to avoid at all costs. At all costs. So this is why I call upon all the saints and sages, ascended ones, the bodhisattvas, and all enlightened Dharma kings, the victorious ones, all those who know the truth, to spare no cost and spare no effort right now, to give an all-out effort to give safe harbor to those who choose this, to give safe harbor to them, to ensure the safest safe harbor possible, to ensure it, and to do this instantly, right now. And this is a prayer I did yesterday, and it's the strongest prayer I've ever done because I actually felt a response from it. I think it's one of the only times in my life I actually sort of felt a response from a prayer, because apparently there's too much time delay in my prayer. So it doesn't seem like I'm getting a response. Later on, I get a response. But this time, I got a response within, you know, a minute or so. I mean, my body started. I felt a tremendous response from it. Of just something intense. It was not anything that I could identify at all. I just, my whole system began, was very much on alert, and I was feeling something. I don't know what exactly it was I was feeling, but there was definitely a response to this prayer, which I just said, Jesus, Holy Spirit, all the liberated ones, the victorious ones, spare no effort whatsoever. Go all out. And I'm insisting, I said, may all who are truly repented and are freeing themselves from sabotage, and this is their objective, may they all be given perfect safe harbor this very instant. perfect safe harbor this very instant. I did not pray for myself. I prayed just for everyone that is so inclined. So I did not say that I'm inclined. I didn't say I'm not. I just said everybody. So it's a very potent prayer. I said, even if I, let's say I'm, let's say for instance, hypothetically, that I'm more of a saboteur. Let's just say that. I said, still, I don't care. All those who are not saboteurs, may they all find safe, perfect safe harbor. This is my prayer for everyone. Now, if it turns out that I'm included in that, great, great. But if I'm not, I still want that for all those, because that means they've worked even more assiduously than I have. They're even more repentant than I am. So all kudos to them for that. All kudos. And so may they find absolute safe harbor immediately, this very instant. And so I emphasized immediately, this very instant. Kept emphasizing that. And so I did feel a response from this prayer. Like I said, maybe the first time in my life I actually felt some response. And people don't believe in prayer because the response is not usually instantaneous. It may be days later, or weeks, or months, or whatever. But those who are expert at prayer, they're able to truly ask for this to happen right now. No delay whatsoever. Delay is what Jesus called the law. It's the Old Testament. Jesus came to free us from the law, which means our valuing of time. That's exactly what it means. By extension, it means our valuing of nature, of physics, of chemistry, of all the dynamics that we think are in play. That's called the law. Time, space, process, and form. Jesus said, I came to free you from the law. A New Testament that frees you from the law, that shows you you're not bound by the law, which is why he did so many miracles, or so many miracles took place in his ministry, to highlight this. So those who are who do not value the law, which is delay, valuing time, trying to make time real, which is really just delay, there they can pray in such a way that the results come either instantaneously or very soon. And this is what we're trying to get to. The more that we can do this, the more people believe. They say, wow. But if you pray for something and nothing happens right away, we say, oh, well, it was ineffective. So I keep praying for safe harbor for all that want it. All those who are inclined in that direction, may they have the safest of safe harbors, a perfectly safe harbor, where they're not at all affected by the attempt to dismiss truth from their minds, and where they can work on a perfect recognition and acceptance of truth. And may they all experience this safe harbor this very moment, instantly, right now, right now. So I again, over and over and over and over, emphasize right now. Powerful. I really gave it everything I had. And again, there were waves of response to this. And if it affected me quite profoundly. And it was just kind of at the level of a neuromuscular or deeper than that level. Kind of, there's something very deep that sort of filtered up through my neuromuscular system. And I was very much shaken by it. The songs should be saying, like, I still remember the first time I saw time walking by. I still remember the first time I first believed in time. You know? Wow, that's crazy. I mean, what happened? I was like, wow, I feel like crazy. Yeah, right. I still remember the first time I saw time walking by. Oh yeah, shoo-bop, shoo-be-boo-bop, shoo-bop. Well, we kind of want to forget the first time we believed in time, right? Because that's when we first felt like we're crazy. That's not something we want to remember. I still forget the first time I saw time walking by. Yeah, can you remind me? I forgot. You know, I forgot. I mean, I thought I saw time walking by, but gee, it's kind of hard to find time, isn't it? I sort of been searching. Whoa, whoa, doo, ah, boo, doo. There goes my time, walking on down the line. We keep thinking we see time. We're confident we see time. So here, let's the two of us, we really think we saw time together. Together we saw time. Wow, let's work. That's something to work on. That's a foundation to work on. Yep, that's what it's, speculation, pop music, music in general, it's all wrapped up in the belief in time. It's all egoic. Be careful of music. Be very careful. It's a slippery slope. And music is very, we find it very difficult to release it all, just to recognize it's all, it's self-released in the now also. We find that difficult, very difficult, because we want to hear the next note. Music leads us, doesn't it? Say, oh, okay, I'm getting this. It's almost complete, but I need to hear the next part. I have to hear the next. So we don't want to see it as self-released in the now, all of it. We want to see it as a process, and a process needs time, it needs space, it needs form. But music too is self-released in the now, all of it. May immaculate, may great, may vast and great snow-covered mountains of clarity immaculately reflect in a beautiful still pool full of blooming lotus blossoms, which is your mind, the mind of all aspirants. Looking towards this exhortation style. The Tibetan Buddhists have a very nice exhortation style, as do classical Christianity. I sort of compare classic Christianity with classic country music in that it's so much better than the modern country music. This is a great analogy. If you know country music, you know. The classic country, if you compare it to the stuff that's being pumped out of Nashville now, I mean, it is, there's no comparison. So I keep harping on this, but may the beautiful harp of accentuating facts be continuously playing in our minds. We don't want it to just be sometimes, and the other time we're believing in the materialistic dismissal of truth. Now we want that harp of truth to be continuously, melodiously playing in our minds, self-released in the now, all notes self-released in the now, of course. It's the self-releasedness in the now that we need to experience and to allow. So it's very important that in any experience you have, do not try to put it into music or for any artistic form, certainly not right off the bat. Let it experience the self inherent self-release this now, like a blazing sun of beautiful spiritual blessings, all continuously fresh and continuously radiating from the sun, like that. And no matter what order we want to put them in, whatever, it's still all the same radiation, right? Continually. And imagine just these rays, infinite rays coming out of a sun. And each of these rays is a beautiful quality. And the rays just keep coming out of the sun. They're so densely packed. We're not trying to establish some order between them. Because they're all, it's all qualities which are wonderful. We're not trying to compound them. We're just experiencing it as it is. Just these qualities just being released in the now. Continuously released in the now. Unfixated radiance is what the goal. Unfixated radiance of blessings, of all blessings, of all types. Unfixated. Never ending. Unfixated and never ending. We must allow this experiencing and accept our identity as like that. It's continuously radiating all qualities and all blessings, all beatitude. Do not try to fixate it. Now, it can be expressed, this unfixated state, unfixated experiencing, can be expressed in art, if you want to. It's a you know, faint echo at best. At best. So, why emphasize faint echoes at best? That should be a minor part of anyone's path. Aesthetically evoking a little bit of that can be of assistance, but it shouldn't comprise the majority of the effort, nor should you be most interested in that. Maybe when you're real tired of all the more important focus, then you might do a little bit. I do some, you know, I put graphics, some beautiful graphics, etc. That's evocative. But the work on doing it is more important than the actual product of it, actually. Just the very effort to evoke it in itself does evoke the actual experience of it, which is what we're really after. So aesthetics are never an end in themselves. Never. This is why I could tell you, I never pay any attention to the music that I created in a previous life. I don't even listen to it. The purpose was evocative. It's not an end in itself. So, if there's better ways to evoke it, and if I can get to it more directly, then that's the goal. I mean, when you see a more direct path, you know, for me, I just put music down. I just put it aside. I put graphics aside and say, wow, I don't need that. I see a much more direct way. So again, this is a great example of, I'm an amazing position, really, to be helpful, because I did so much musical composition in the life previous to this one. And so well known, so well received, still is, massive canon of work, and yet I'm not attached to it at all. Don't care about it, don't listen to it, it's not important to me. I did the best I could do at that time, based on the clarity I had and the overall culture, etc. Try to move people away from materialism. Okay, unfortunately, well, it wasn't perfectly successful because Europe went into extreme materialism, and with fascism and Nazism and terrible wars, World War One, World War Two. So I tried to head off that trend. But there's better ways to head it off than music. Like, and I found better ways, for sure. It's the focus on hearing the spiritual truth and the great examples of enlightenment. That is more effective than music, way more effective. So I don't place any faith in music to save the world at all. I've already made some of the highest efforts ever done in that direction, and it didn't work. Okay, I can't say categorically it had no effect. It may have lessened the intensity of it. Okay, that is conceivable that it might have been even worse if not for those who tried to do their very best to head it off in some way, right? That's possible. But certainly, there are better ways. This is how I see it. Much more powerful ways. Much more effective ways. Just an enlightened being here in this world is way more effective than some, uber clever composer. Super dedicated, inspired, clever, a genius composer. It can't compare, cannot compare to the effectiveness of an actual enlightened being here. Cannot compare. So it's small time. It's small potatoes. Music is small potatoes. We must understand. Now, sometimes a few small potatoes, we like to eat a few small potatoes, but it's not a big meal, right? Small potatoes. So we just have to be aware of this, very much aware of it. And don't put too much focus. I mean, I again fell into putting too much focus on music this lifetime. Because the culture just doesn't support enlightened beings being here. And it's so supportive of music, this culture, isn't it? Materialism is very supportive of music. Because it's small potatoes. And it's easy to turn that towards commercialism, materialism, special relationship, all that, right? I mean, you look at the musicians who got so furious when their music, they lost control of it, the catalog, the publishing rights, all this, and then the publisher, whoever held the publishing rights, would sell a song for a jingle, commercial jingle. You see, that happened so much. I mean, and those of us who grew up in the 60s, where we wanted to prevent that from happening, it was very important to us that this music would not be commercialized in that way. So when you hear one of these songs that we took so seriously being used to sell, deodorant or whatever, right? Soap. Ah. I mean, that really bums us out. Brutal. Brutal. Our whole thing is don't sell out. Don't sell out to the man. Don't sell out to the corporations. Don't sell your music to corporations. That was like bedrock ideology. You do not sell your music to corporations. And to see it now sold to corporations, just killer, But now it's so commonplace. And the political campaigns use it, and what someone who wrote a song who's very much a liberal, some conservative uses it for their political campaign. It drives them nuts, and vice versa. They take music so seriously, but yet, look what happens to it. It's, don't take music too seriously. And again, I'm a great example of that. I took it with the ultimate seriousness. And now I realize, don't take it so seriously. Be more playful with it. I can zip in and out of it, and let it go, just self-released in the now. Change the lyrics, change the meaning of it, use it if you want to, for your purposes, spiritual purposes. But don't take music too seriously. It will bite you very badly if you do. There's better ways to be influential and help out, actually. Way better ways. Harping. Where do you go to hear someone harping? To hear harping upon this, constantly playing these beautiful strings. This is what I'm astonished about in this world. Where do you go? I have to do it myself. I can't find any anywhere. Television? Radio? where do you go? Well, people say, well, you can turn on Catholic radio or Christian radio or something, but they're mostly harping on Old Testament stuff. Inevitably, they don't really know the New Testament. They don't really know. Christians don't really know the New Testament. You know that? Because they haven't truly repented. They don't really get it. So they keep falling back into Old Testament stuff and harping on that. Endlessly they'll harp on that. Endlessly they'll harp on it. This has nothing to do with Jesus, actually. It's opposite of what Jesus taught. It's belief in the law. You can't have it both ways. And they try to stitch it together and say, but this is what, you know, that the law and what Jesus taught are compatible. And we can have both. And no. Jesus said the law has no force, binding force upon us whatsoever. None. We're free of it. Ultimately, if you keep looking at it, you realize it's all pretense. There's no reality to it whatsoever. So this is what Jesus is getting at. And you have to keep following along and listen to the Holy Spirit and gradually become more and more aware of this. So harping on the Old Testament is completely counter to what Jesus wants us to do. So where do you go to hear continuous clarity about the true facts, about facts about truth, the facts of truth? This is what's astonishing in this world. You've got to give kudos to the Tibetan Buddhists. And looking at what they do, their overall system that they set up, my gosh, did they go for it, you know, all in. And their way, you know, is a very thorough, complete approach. It doesn't necessarily translate well to different cultures in terms of the actual practicing of it all, because it's you have to really, you really almost have to grow up in that culture to really appreciate and get with it. I mean, intellectually I can see it. I can recognize, okay, this would be helpful, this, but it's based on the having this super positive attitude towards teachers and the truth. And they say this is necessary for the momentum to give you. So you're brought up with this great reverence for truth and teachers of truth and the Dharma, and you're brought up with all this practicing as being seen as very important and very helpful, and so you have a very positive attitude towards it all. So it's a cultural thing, very strong. It's embedded in cultural attitudes and acceptance. If you don't have that in your culture, then this is a whole different story. We do not have that super positive outlook anymore. We have a super negative outlook to the tradition, Judeo-Christian traditions, for instance. I mean, we spend most of our time undermining it. I mean, this to Tibetan Buddhism, this is unthinkable. They have very, very strong injunctions. In Longchenpa, some of his pith instructions, they talk about the attitude. They say, under no circumstances ever have a critical attitude towards your lama, your teacher, your tulku, lama, Rinpoche, various honorific titles, your teacher, under no circumstances. And they say, if you have a negative thought or a doubt about your teacher, this will send you to unending hells of torment. And you must make great expiation of this and ask for forgiveness and recant. And, you know, I mean, it's like super important. You absolutely do not criticize them. You do not have a negative attitude. And we just, in the West, we just simply cannot hardly comprehend this at this point. Now, it used to be that way toward Jesus and the apostles and the Christian saints. you did not take the name of God in vain. You did not take Jesus' name in vain. You did not say, criticize them. You did not say anything negative. It used to be that way. This is very, very important culturally, because sabotage is always looking to creep in and sabotage your path. And so you have to make a conscious effort to praise the goal. Praise the goal. Praise the goal. Keep praising the goal. This is embedded in Tibetan Buddhist culture to almost an ultimate extent. And their whole system is predicated upon this. It really is. So if that is missing, then it doesn't work so well. Now I can look at it and say, yeah, but it's not going to work for me. This is how I feel. I can't really take that path. It's rather it's very heavily culturally dependent. But it's not the only path there is by any means. There's the contemplative path. The path of discipline and perseverance wins out, no matter what. Now, they have ways to speed it up. I mean, their whole thing is to speed it up. But so to speed it up, you have to be all in. I mean, the stuff that they say to do is just, you have to absolutely believe and have faith in your teachers and be all in to speed it up in the way that they teach. That doesn't mean that their ways to speed it up are the only ways. No, by no means is that true. Wow. I'm driving along with a... My gosh. Let me see. What did I do here? Well... give me any options here. Very interesting. Very, very heavy right now. Load. Extremely heavy. Dangerously heavy. Driving along, and suddenly right in front of me is a big black on the freeway garbage bag full of something, and it's tumbling around. So I had to take evasive moves to drive around, and I did. You don't know what's in that bag. But you don't want to be taking evasive measures in a cumbersome situation, do you? But I was able to do it. Including, so, wow, interesting. And ultimately the black bag, I looked back and it split open and stuff was flying all over the freeway, which had been even more discombobulating, right? So I was able to sidestep that black bag before it all split open. I was able to do it successfully. I didn't have to swerve too much. I just saw it and said, okay, I've got room. Let me just steer. I just steered around it. Pretty great metaphor for what's going to happen right now in the world, right? Coming up. In hindsight, I look back and said, oh my gosh, it's spilling all over the freeway. And there is just debris flying everywhere. And that's, again, very disconcerting for a driver. Very disconcerting. So the fragmentation that is to come in this world, the belief in fragmentation is so disconcerting. The belief that somehow we're all different instead of, in fact, we're all the same. The belief that we make our own reality. Instead of there's just one reality that we all have. All of this falsity spread out all over the freeway. Very distracting. Very, very troublesome. So if I ask myself, would I be successful with Tibetan Buddhism? No, I wouldn't be. Wouldn't be. I don't visualize at all the way they do it. The various, the mantras and stuff. I'm not into any of that stuff. If I was born into that culture, it would be a different story, I'm sure. Is it helpful? I'm sure it is, because many have succeeded in that way. But you really have to have a top-notch teacher. And their system is such, there's many, many, many knowledgeable teachers. And you have to really, they take you through all the visualizations, all the mandalas, etc., and the mantras, and they know what the goal is with that, you know, where the transference, the flipping of the script of the energetic qualities are, and they evaluate the person's particular dance of continuity fear. You know, our continuity fear gives us a sense of uniqueness, but ultimately, once the continuity fear is gone, we realize that there's just one mind for everyone, one perfect responsiveness to everyone. We all have access to it, perfect access to it. Now there might be those who didn't grow up in the culture who can get with that. It's possible. I mean, there's some anomalies like that, but I'm not stressing like Longchenpa to say people should practice Tibetan Buddhism. That would be foolish to say that. I would say stay within your own tradition. Stay within your own tradition, which I do. I'm still very much in the tradition of Judeo-Christian tradition and Jesus Christ and his ministry, which includes A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words. That's part of Jesus' ministry. I mean, it's amazing to me how people say they love Jesus so much. And they say, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Well, are they aware of Jesus' ministry, which is ongoing? Do they think that Jesus' ministry stopped back 2,000 years ago? Stopped? What is that? Do they believe Jesus rose from the dead and is alive and lives? Well, isn't his ministry continuing? Of course it continues through the church and the Holy Spirit and all that, yes. Yes, but what about Jesus himself? Is he not still doing everything he can do? Of course he must be. How could we possibly think otherwise? What other motivation could Jesus possibly have but to be doing everything possible to help us? So, why aren't they aware that Jesus, his ministry, is continuing here and he's added to it? They keep saying, no, the book is closed. The book is closed. What book is closed? Did Jesus write a book back then? Is it closed? It's not closed. His ministry is not closed. It's not a closed book. It's an open book. It's an open book. Why can't we believe that we could have progressed to a point where Jesus could say, okay, now I can give you some more advanced teaching. Remember, he said back then, he said, I'm only teaching you very simply, parables, metaphors, allegories, whatever, because you're very, very primitive in your understanding. Very primitive. And he says, later on, you will understand much better. I'll be able to speak much more plainly to you. He said that. So, right? Of course he said that. And that's the truth. So, Jesus has produced another, more aspects of his ministry with A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words and The Other Voice, which supplement A Course in Miracles. He's done that for us. So how can we say that we're Christians and ignore Jesus' ministry? This is bizarre. It's absurd. And the people who object to A Course in Miracles, they're Old Testament. They have an Old Testament mindset. Very much so. Very much so. I didn't have any problem with it. I said, wow, this is a further clarification. Thank you very much. This fits in very much with your New Testament. Doesn't fit in with the Old Testament at all. But back then, people were so welded to the Old Testament stuff. Just like now, we're trying to weld ourselves back to the law. That's the worst thing possible. This is what Jesus came to free us from. The belief in time, space, process, and form. Belief we can make time real is welding ourselves to belief in the law. In law. We don't mean just legal stuff on the books. Legalism implies this belief in time, space, process, and form. This is what we must, Jesus came to free us from. And here we are, about ready to spot weld ourselves in a million different ways to the belief in the belief system Jesus called the law. He's referring to a belief system. So there's nothing that Jesus said in A Course in Miracles that really disagrees with what he said in the Bible, actually. It enhances it. It augments it. It enhances. It clarifies. It empowers it. But it certainly doesn't empower the Old Testament, the legalism of it all. The law, not at all. It says that stuff's made up. Absolutely wishful thinking. Nothing more than that. He says the entire world here is just a reflection in our mind of our attempt to make time real, our valuing of time. That's it. That's all it is. That's all the law is. The kingdom of the flesh refers to the law. The kingdom of the flesh is just a reflection in our mind of a desire we have to make absurdity true. That's all that it is. So a lot of people with faith in Jesus have paid attention to the furtherance of his ministry, A Course in Miracles. So we don't have to judge Jesus just in the Bible, which is what the materialists are trying to do. They're trying to tear the Bible to pieces and then judge Jesus accordingly. How ridiculous is that? How ridiculous. Completely ignoring the continuance of his ministry. They totally ignore that. They can't put two and two together at all. Cannot put two and two together. Well, they can, but they refuse to. That's the difference, right? They most certainly can. We all can. But they say, but that would undo the theory of absurdity. The theory of how absurdity becomes real. That would undo that. We can't have that. That would be absurd. They say it's absurd to try to undo our belief in absurdity. And that in itself is a defense of absurdity, isn't it? I don't have to leave the tradition, my roots and this overall tradition of Jesus' ministry at all, in order to get consultation and help and reinforcement from various sources. They don't conflict with what Jesus said at all. They do conflict with Old Testament nonsense. They most certainly do. Not everything in the Old Testament's nonsense. Some of the prophets and there's some helpfulness there here and there. But it's not what Jesus wants to emphasize at all. He brought a New Testament. So we could set the Old Testament aside, really. We really can. Just as ultimately Jesus said, we'll set A Course in Miracles aside. We won't need it. We won't need it, he says, ultimately. So he's not attached to his teaching. He's not attached to his teaching. Understand, it's just a faint echo. And it doesn't really give us the experience at all that we need. We must experience the unfixated nature of all that is. And how all qualities are unfixated. They're omnipresent. Awareness is not a derivative of any compoundment. It is not a derivative. It is primary. Spaciousness, pure spaciousness, is not a derivative of what we call things or thingness, compoundness. It is not a derivative. It is primary. Completely primary. Completely primordial. a store, and Beatles song is playing. Something in the way she moves attracts me like, you know, that one. It's amazing. You go back to the songs of the 60s, and it was called the time of the girls, the idolization of girls. Absolutely, it was unbelievable. It's just bizarre looking back at it. Every song was about girls, and you know, young girls, young women, girls were idolized back then. Idolized. They had all the answers to it, to you know, for us. And so these songs, it just, you know, are like odes of, it was a very romantic time, the 60s, of romanticizing that always, usually, almost always it tends to be towards young women. It's like, you have the answer to my, you're the answer to my life. I mean, just listen to the songs, the lyrics. It's just incredible. How could we have been so insane? So, I'm not necessarily saying the music back then was better. I go back to classic country. Well, classic country certainly was, you might say, a lot better than the country today. The country today, oh my gosh. It's idolization of young relationships, basically. And women, young women too, just like, wow, they're so hot, it's unbelievable. Basically, country songs, just like, wow, I just, you know, I think I'll get a little drunk and go dancing with some hot women. Wow, this is just unbelievable, you know, how hot women are. Wow. Well, classic country is more like, life sucks. I hate it. It's pulverized me. That's right. And you ain't helping too much either, you know. It's like talks about the special relationship. The special relationship ain't helping much. In fact, it's making it worse. You don't hear that in country music now. It's saying, "My God, the special relationship is out of this world. I'm just crazy about it, man. I'm gonna go down, get myself a six pack, go down the river, just talk and just have a good old time. Talk about how great the special relationship. Wow." Look at those torn jeans on that lady. Wow. I mean, it's just devolved into a parody, you know. It's a parody. I think people look back and say, what were we thinking? But I like classic country to some extent. Some of the stuff's pretty also romantic. But a lot of it is just saying, wow. I mean, she just, you know, threw me out in the street. Because I just, you know, couldn't stop drinking because we just can't get along anymore. And I don't know where the magic went, but it's gone. And I don't know what I'm going to do now. Maybe I'll just go down to a bar and keep drinking. I don't know. But I ain't ever going back again. I just don't give a damn anymore. Maybe tomorrow. I'll wake up feeling lonely, but tonight I just don't give a damn. Don't call me. Don't bother calling me. If you want to see me, I'll be on the other side of town. You know, that through. It's like that. And so, a little further on down the road here, I don't watch the news. I don't know what's happening. Occasionally people make remarks and say, oh, did you hear this? That something's really important to them. So I hear about it that way, but that's it. I don't know anything that's going on. Except I know all the trends that are going on, actually. And so I know what's really going on, and I don't pay attention to the distraction, the stuff that are distractions, actually. Red herrings dragged across your path to, you catch the scent of that. Oh, I gotta follow that scent. Don't follow the scent of anything. Don't follow the scent, except the scent of truth, which is a clear scent. Follow the clear scent. Feel the clear scent. What is that like? What is that like? Abide in the clear scent. Follow the clear scent. Wow. So, I've been saying that I excommunicated the Pope, which I can do, being an apostle of Jesus. Jesus is the true head of the church, and he invested authority in his apostles, those who have truly repented and have truly heard what he has to say and understand what he has to say. And since he's already back in this world, it means the Pope is not the head of the church anymore, actually. And the Pope is a flat-out materialist, 100% flat-out Marxist liberation theologist, materialist. He's a materialist, plain and simple. And apparently, he's told Catholics and Christians that they can't vote for Trump. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. So, an excommunicated, disgraced Pope says that you're not a good Christian if you vote for Trump. Wow. I guess what he's saying is you're not a good new world order dictatorship, tyrant, fascist, materialist if you vote for Trump, is what he's really trying to say. I fixed it there for him. Of course, I don't vote. I don't vote. I also don't own stock in any business or corporation. I have no investments whatsoever. Zero. So I'm objective. I can afford to be objective. Nobody is paying me off to think one way or the other about anything. It's very important. Just consider that. I consider myself to be a true scientist because I am not beholden to anyone. I simply follow where the evidence indicates. There is no grant money whatsoever in my life. None. So I have no problem saying boycott Apple computer. Most people, a lot of people own stock in Apple. They would never say such a thing, right? Say, oh, no, maybe that's so good. But. So it's amazing how much money talks. And you're never going to get someone who owns stock in Apple to boycott Apple, will you? Never. So what is their ideology based on? Their investments. Jesus says, where your treasure is, there your mind will be also. So I don't have any treasure in this world. Don't have any. Nothing to defend. This world is becoming materialistic so fast. It's all converging. Now the Pope is the Pope of materialism. And I'm telling you, materialists love the Pope. They say he's the first good Pope we've ever had. The best, greatest one ever. They love the Pope. But he's not a Pope. He's not a Pope of the Catholic Church. Let's make this very plain and simple. This, whatever his name is, he calls himself Francis, but he's a liberation theologist from, what is it, Argentina or something. He is not the Pope of the Catholic Church. Okay, he is not the Pope of the Catholic Church. He's a Jesuit, New World Order, Marxist, materialistic Jesuit, who is, he's an imposter. He's an imposter Pope, plain and simple. Just like the president's an imposter president. These people are simply Marxist materialists, plain and simple. And this is a catastrophe. Jesus knows it is. Jesus absolutely knows it is. As, of course, does the Holy Spirit. It's amazing. But, we don't need to... I don't need to study the mind of materialism. I already know it. I already understand all that stuff. It's like all the garbage that comes out isn't important to study. It's just garbage. It's futility. It's like, well, what scheme will help make absurdity real? Well, none of them will. So why do we need to sort and categorize them? You could do that from a top-down position. Just say, well, there's certain people that have certain tendencies. So, well, this technique will work for that. I mean, the Tibetan Buddhists know all that kind of stuff. If we need to use it, we'll let them take care of it. That's fine. Longchenpa, I'm sure, could write a spiritual prescription for every one of us. In terms of, well, this particular practice may speed things up for you and you need this sort of, path like that. That's a piece of cake for them, no problem. Okay. But it's a top-down view. They don't have to study the mind of materialism to know this. You don't. All right, it's not necessary. Just be absolutely clear about reality. And then reality will inform you based on the grace of the Holy Spirit, how to proceed. That's what's called for in teachers. So the insanity, there's no new insanity under the sun. And materialists keep thinking they're discovering new forms of insanity. No, there's no new insanity under the sun. It's all the same dance of continuity fear is all it is. It's all a dance of imagination. It's all, as Jesus says, hallucination. It's all hallucination. And that's the key point. I mean, exactly what you're hallucinating, the whole thing is to say that's not important. What's important is to realize you are hallucinating. Not what is it exactly that I'm hallucinating and how many grains of sand am I hallucinating. The hallucinator says, well, I'm hallucinating. Well, how many grains of sand am I hallucinating? I need to count them. I need to sort them. And once I count them, then I'm going to sort them out in terms of size. And then I'm going to sort them out in terms of quality. And then I'm going to sort them out in terms of overall aesthetics. And then I'm going to sort them out in terms of facets. And I'm going to sort them out. And they just keep sorting out. And the whole time, they're just still hallucinating. And they're paying no attention to the fact that they're hallucinating. And how do we get free of that hallucination? They're just simply avoiding all that. So I found out some new fact about hallucination. You know, it works. We can hallucinate this way. We can hallucinate that way. No, it's all just, all hallucination is simply hallucination. There's not different types of hallucination. Hallucination means to see something that's not there. So, by definition, there's only one type of hallucination. It doesn't matter what specifically you're hallucinating. You say, well, it's not like you hallucinate a rock, and that's a different type of hallucination than hallucinating a tree. It's the same. It's the same. So everybody thinks they have different problems. Well, we've got to fix the problems. Trillions of different problems. Wow, it's going to take us for a long time to fix these problems. This person's hallucinating some pebbles, and this person's hallucinating a sky, and this person... And everybody's hallucinating something different. By gosh, we've got to get a medicine for every single one of those. It's very complex. No, it's all the same. It's just hallucinating. It doesn't matter what you're hallucinating. This is the point that spiritual teaching is directing us towards. Directing us towards. And it's the point that materialism is directing us away from. So it's a very simple point of emphasis. It's all that it's at really at in contention. It's just a simple point of emphasis. That's all. So those who see this don't need to keep studying materialism at all. There's no need for it. It won't help us be better teachers. In fact, it will hinder us greatly from being great teachers. It's a great hindrance. Because what we have to do is be very resolute of pointing to what you're hallucinating doesn't matter. We have to be super resolute in that. And their whole point is what we are hallucinating does matter. They say it's causing the hallucination. The tree is causing it. You know, the causation is outside the mind. This is the insanity. So, to be a great teacher, you have to be totally resolute. Totally resolute. We've had some great examples of that in the world. You truly have to be made of Teflon. I mean, nothing can stick to you. Nothing. No. Specificity about hallucination can stick to you at all. This is key. So you don't become a better teacher by hanging out with materialists. Okay, you just get an argument. You get nowhere. You have to hang out in good company. Hang out in a world that's reflecting truth. That the intensity of worshiping time is much, 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 much diminished. Greatly diminished. Greatly diminished. Because again, if we are to help out anyone, we cannot be split-minded. Okay? Cannot have dissociation that both are true. That both lies and truth are true. You cannot have that. That's an anti-teacher. That's a false teacher. Teaching what? False confidence. You can have it both ways. That absurdity can be true and truth can be absurdity. They say, yeah, we have it both ways. We're more advanced than God. You see, we've seen it. No, we're just in a grievous suffering is what we're in. Grievous confusion. That's we go about our day here with intensity, right? With intensity. Now, just to smooth out the intensity, let's smooth out a little bit here. I can switch over to my old standby, the golf game. Because it reflects, golf reflects your mind, actually. It's very reflective, extremely reflective of your mind. Amazingly so. Everything we do is, actually. But golf really brings it out. And so I'm spending my time and effort, not so much on my golf swing, a little bit, but much more on the peripherals of how to get organized properly, how to remain smooth on the golf course, how to be at ease on the golf course. What can you do to smooth it out? No matter how you're playing, there's some people who they call debonair. It doesn't matter what they're doing. They all seem smooth, and we all marvel at these folks. Say, oh, I wish I could be so debonair like that. It's just, I mean, they have a pratfall, and it turns into, like, it's just all smooth. Like, yeah, this is just like part of my smoothness, you know. It's all perfectly fine. I mean, nothing. So, on the golf course, if you aren't smoothed out, then you're going to get flustered. You will get flustered. So what I did last time, I got most stuff right, and I did most things right, but I had a few areas that I hadn't smoothed out, and it bit me real bad, real bad. It's amazing. It's amazing what happened. I hit one ball over the fence, almost onto the road, and I climbed over the fence, which is the boundary of the golf course, actually. I climbed over the fence to look for my ball, and there's these two ladies, and these were very disheveled ladies. These were drug-using, tattooed, disheveled, and they were just shuffling along the street, you know, no job, no focus, no purpose. I could tell, uh-oh. So I said, I got to get back over this fence. And they're yelling out to me. They start from a distance, hey, did you find your ball? Hey, like that. I said, uh-oh, this is trouble. This is, I could tell. So they said, hey, I want to ask you a question. Hey, wait. I said, no, I got it. So I climbed back over the fence as fast as possible. And they kind of ran up. Oh, no, wait, don't go. I got to ask you a question. And then they asked me some question. What's the difference between an eagle and a birdie? I got to know. I sell magazines for a living. So I got to know. I get asked this question. So I explained it to them. I was on the side. But that rattled me. It rattled me. And it was pointing out something. Stay on course. Don't leave the course. Don't leave the course. What's a course? Well, A Course in Miracles, for instance. A Course in Miracles. So I'm grounded in A Course in Miracles, which is grounded in Jesus' teaching. The other teachers never asked me to leave that at all. Not at all. I can be aware of it. But also it pointed out something else. Stay on course. It was on the left side of the golf course. Don't engage the left, for example. Don't engage him. It's pretty important. And this is coming, more and more I'm realizing it. Don't engage with them. They just ask stupid questions. I mean, and they don't have any context. They don't even know anything about golf. I'm trying to explain the difference between an eagle and a birdie. Oh, thanks. Now I know. Really? Really? They know? They know the overall context of it. They can explain it clearly to someone. Not a chance. Not a chance. So it's a waste of my time. It's a waste of time explaining anything to those who are not repentant, because they are trying to make absurdity real. And they believe they can do it, which in itself is more absurdity. That's why Jesus said, you never get in the kingdom of heaven unless you repent, which is very true. Which is to say, okay, instead of all this specificity I'm trying to do, legalism, let me look at the premise and let me determine what is a true premise, because that matters. Whereas absurdity says it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter, because absurdity is saying God doesn't matter, that we can separate from God, that causation, spiritually, as far as extension, that type of causation, it doesn't matter, that we can turn the direction of creation around. This is what we're trying to do. So, of course, we think, oh, causation doesn't matter. So that's what absurdity says. That's what absurdity says. So it's futile talking with absurdity. It really is. And the problem is almost everyone here is into materialism now. And they've just learned a smattering of spirituality so they can say, yeah, I know that too. Yeah, I know that stuff. That doesn't interfere with my belief at all. I can still believe premises don't matter and still believe spirituality. Of course I can. I know those words, sure. Oh, yeah. That's pretty the extent of it. Pretty much so. There are some that are grinding away, hidden in nooks and crannies, kind of. But they're kind of like, you know, solitary, but you don't even know about them. They're trying to weather the storm, basically. I mean, they batten down the hatches and trying to weather the storm. There's a big storm coming. The materialists are feeling very perky indeed, and there's nothing that gives them greater courage of their convictions than the Pope. I mean, they just do cartwheels. They say, oh my gosh, everything we thought about materialism is true. Now the Pope is affirming it. Oh, this is like wonderful Pope. The Pope is affirming our entire belief system. Of course, the whole purpose of Christianity is to disaffirm materialism and to affirm truth, which is absolute freedom from what the tenets of materialism. That the tenets of materialism are completely false, totally false, without any foundation whatsoever in reality. That's the whole purpose of Christianity. And the Pope is an antichrist, plain and simple. He teaches the exact opposite of that. And it throws in a smattering of feel-good, you know, let me wash your feet. Let me go to a woman's shelter and wash their feet. And oh, what a great, you know, we got to follow him now, you know, that kind of thing. And who's he fooling? Who's he think he's fooling? Well, he's fooling the materialists is what he's fooling, because they're easily fooled. But the real Christians, a lot of them are not fooled. Thank God for that. But the pressure will be on very severely. The end times, some of the end times talks about, prophecy talks about an alliance between the Pope and the President. Well, we have one, don't we? We absolutely, we're going very fast in that direction. Because they basically say, hey, we talk in the same language, you know. We're down together, man. We, you know, we're brothers. We're brothers. Absolutely. Materialistic brothers. Marxist materialistic brothers. Soul brothers in Marxism and materialism. Speaking the same language, we're going in the same direction, booging on down the road. They certainly are. They most certainly are. And there you have a big billboard here with a woman dressed in men's clothes and her sleeve rolled up to show her bicep. She's flexing her bicep with a very aggressive, tough, mean looking look on her face. Yep. Ah, you know, you see the one, you see them all. You know, why you're right. You see one materialist, you see them all. So why spend time counting them? You know, that doesn't matter. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing is done, right? Thank you, Kenny Rogers. And again, of course, to reemphasize, Catholicism, Christianity, super important. All religious traditions are super important, super helpful. What I'm saying is they're in big trouble. They're in big, big trouble. And don't get pulled down into that trouble. The real church is Jesus, and ultimately it's the Holy Spirit, and ultimately it's God. Okay. Don't let the flesh boss you around and tell you what your Christian religion has to be, or any religion. Don't let the voice of the flesh, which is the ego, which is absurdity, which is arrogance, spiritual pride, don't let that tell you what path you have to follow. You don't have to please the flesh. Christianity is not here to please the flesh. And the Pope is the, you know, great pleasure, flesh pleaser. And the flesh just loves the Pope. I mean, the flesh says this is the greatest thing that's ever happened in the world. I'm so glad I'm here alive today to see this great, finally, you know, it's all on track. No, actually, finally, the train is off the track. which is what absurdity wants, of course. And then they wonder why, absurdity wonders why it's got an attraction to drugs and sex and drugs and rock and roll and addictions and everybody's wonders. Ah, I can't quite understand that one. I'll cure that one too. That's because they, deep down, they feel something's drastically wrong. Drastically wrong. And they don't have a clue what to do about it. So try to drown it. Try to drown the feeling. Kill the feeling. Yeah, something's drastically wrong. That doesn't work out well either, does it? Sad. Sad but true. Sad but true. And yet, you don't get to be a better teacher by hanging out and counting the cows, you know. You don't. You only become a better teacher by becoming more adamant. That's the only way. These great teachers were absolutely adamant. My four great teachers, absolutely 100% adamant. Never back down. Totally adamant. They told Jesus they wanted to kill him. He said, really? He said, you can't harm a hair on my head if it weren't given unto you to do so. If I didn't agree with that. If it weren't the plan of God here to show you something here. They said, ah, what nonsense. So Jesus said, okay, you want to kill his body? Fine, no problem. I'll raise it up again in 3 days. Okay? They said, ah, what an idiot, you know. Let's get rid of this moron. Yep. Well, they're still trying to get rid of him so they can feel less moronic themselves. It's a pity, but it's true. So, again, we have every right to not spend our future hanging out with these materialists. We have every right. And because, it again, what they need are adamant teachers. And until we're perfectly adamant, we are probably just going to exacerbate their problems, actually. And they will just use us as punching bags, actually, is what happens. They say, I just need a good workout against some religious person so I can strengthen my materialistic views. You know, so, oh, here comes one. Let me start punching him. It's like that. There'll be lynch mobs pretty soon. I mean, everything is coming pretty soon. History is clear about this. Materialistic mindset projects their own absurdity onto others who are not trying to be not absurd, and then attacks it there and claims that they're insane. It gets real bad. So sidestep it. Let's sidestep it. So to go over it again, which is very helpful, to continually repeat the truth, the facts, over and over again to those who of us were all very unfamiliar with the facts. And so we need to hear it again and again and again and again and again. And this is what's important. That the whole purpose of Christianity is to point out that the belief system we call materialism is not true. It's false. Not only is it not true, anything that's not true is false. Materialism is a false belief system. It is not true. Okay, and there is a truth that is true. This is the whole basis of Christianity. That's the whole purpose of it. And here's the Pope saying that materialism is true. And that the other part of Christianity says, you know, it's not important. Maybe we'll keep it around for a little while. So that's anti-Christian. Antichrist, to abbreviate, is anti-Christian. Pope is anti-Christian. As is the president, to say the least. To say the very least. He doesn't even try to fake that one. You know, he's just blatantly anti-Christian. Purpose of Christianity again is to make it very clear that the belief system, that materialism is a belief system, and it's a false belief. It's a belief in falsity. That's why Jesus did all those miracles. He said, look, there is no law. There is no materialism isn't true. And they said, well, you can't do that, Jesus. That violates all the principles of materiality. He says, it's all a dream. It's all hallucination. It's imagination. It's a pretense. It's not true. So I can turn the water into wine. Simply I decide that's what I want it to be, and that's what it is. That we're the sovereign spirit. We're spirit. We're sovereign over all our experiencing. Nothing can ever happen to us that we don't choose to experience. And that remains true forever and ever. We can never experience anything that changes the truth of what we are. It's impossible. So Christianity is based on, its purpose is to point out the belief system of we call materialism, secular materialism, is false. It is absolutely false. So the purpose of a pope, or the head of the church, is to be relentlessly adamant about this, to set the tone for all Christians worldwide. Who in their right mind thinks that if Jesus was sitting on the throne of St. Peter right now, that he would be a Marxist liberation theologist and be pleasing all the materialists of the world? Who could possibly believe such a thing after Jesus, the miracles he did, and the accounts of which are in the Bible, and then A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, Other Voice? How could anyone believe that Jesus would agree with the Pope at all in any of this? And the fact of the matter is, he would not in the slightest bit. So how can this Pope be the vicar of Christ? He's not. Unless you think that all that Jesus was about was being nice to your neighbor. Marxist redistributionism, which is it's a different story. That's arguing about economic principles of which, how do we organize materiality? How do we organize the belief system of materiality? Jesus says it's a false belief system. Free yourself from that false belief system. That's what you must do. That's the same that all great teachers have said. Same message. So you have this extremely dangerous situation where the materialists now believe that they know what a good Christian is better than the Christians know, because the Pope is siding with them. So the materialists are going to say, look, we love Christianity, we love religion, and we will determine who is a good Christian because we know way better than you do, and there's some of you Christians aren't good Christians at all. Because you don't agree with the Pope. And you're not agreeing with us. So they, in their massive overconfidence, absurd overconfidence, they think they know what a good Christian is. And they think that they have the right then to fix the church, to fix what's wrong with the church. And to set up re-education camps says, we'll teach you what real Christianity is really about. And we have all these drugs and treatments that'll help you out, because some of you Christians are suffering from genetic defects and some mental aberrations and mental problems. And we'll be able to fix those, don't worry. Stand up for truth, stand up for truth. I say to all the great teachers, stand up for truth right now. Your presence matters. It's important. So now we're seeing these trends converging, are we not? When I'm talking about convergence of trends, this is a great example of what is going to happen. The convergence of Catholicism, at least the hierarchy of it, with secular Marxist humanism, will then have the overconfidence of claiming they know who is really, truly religious, rightly religious and spiritual, and who isn't. And of course, they'll have it exactly upside down and backwards. And then they'll feel righteous about persecution. Of course they will. They're super persecutors. Materialists have always been super persecutors throughout history. Well, their persecution, they do it in a different style. They can. I mean, they'll say, well, yeah, we don't, nobody, no more cash. Everybody has to do, you know, we have to trace every last thing you do to make sure you're a good Christian. But that's not control. That's good for you. We're just weeding out the bad Christians and helping them, retraining them. So they don't see it as being vicious and totalitarian. And all the criticisms they have of others, they don't see it that way at all. Not at all. Not even remotely do they see that. I've tested them out. They don't have a clue about what they're up to in terms of how absurd it is. It's an absurdist philosophy. Materialism is an absurdist philosophy from the very beginning. From the very beginning. And it's never ever been anything other than that. And never will. It never will be anything other than an absurdist philosophy, no matter how you dress it up. You can dress it up in a white cassock and a white beanie cap with incense and metal ornamentations and stuff. Build a stone house and set the dummy on a throne in there, and it's still absurdist philosophy. It's still an absurdist belief system, completely. And you get to the point where they're going to say, well, if you don't agree with the Pope, you're a bad Catholic. You're a bad Christian. Trump's saying he's a bad Christian. I thought speaking truth to authority, standing up for freedom, I thought that was part of being a good Christian. Not the only thing. I don't know if he's a good Christian or not. But I know he certainly feels that he has the right to examine issues and speak up on them if he disagrees with them. Tries to use reason as best he can, and but to say that you're a bad Christian, wow, this is storm clouds gathering. I'd say the bad Christian is the Pope, more than Trump. I say Trump's probably a better Christian than the Pope is, actually. In fact, I will say that. I just said it. Trump is a better Christian than the Pope, plain and simple. That's a very low bar, That's a very low bar. So I'm not saying that Trump is some super Christian by any means. Okay, don't get me wrong on that. I don't know. He's a better Christian than the Pope. How about that for flipping the script? I don't think he's so corrupted like the Pope is corrupted. I don't think he's so hell-bent on materialistic philosophy. I mean, he's a capitalist, works hard, employs a lot of people, tries to do very good work, builds great golf courses. I mean, he does, he tries to give quality. He's a materialist in some regards, certainly, but not a diehard fanatic materialist like the Pope is. He's someone that you might be able to straighten out. He's someone that might actually repent. Pope doesn't think he needs to repent. Now he can be all humble and stuff and play the humble poor card, and then, yeah, of course they know how to play that card. I'm part of the proletariat, part of the people. I take a bus to work, I take a taxi. That's just a Marxist thing. I'm down with the proletariat, so the proletariat will support me. That's just Marxist posturing. It doesn't qualify you to be Pope. At least Trump says, look, this is what I am. This is who I am. This is what I believe in. I'm not, he's not trying to deceive everybody and thinking that I'm something that I'm not. Not trying to put him on a pedestal here at all, but I'm just using bringing up an important issue here. I feel way more threatened by the Pope than I do by Trump. Way more threatened, by almost infinitely so. Trump's not trying to define for me what a good Christian is. The Pope is. And the Pope doesn't know what a good Christian is because he's not one himself. That's what's dangerous. I've been invited by Jesus to his dwelling place already. Personally, he invited me directly. So I'd say I'm a pretty good Christian. He's not going to give an invite like that unless he knows that I have paid attention to what he believes in and what he stands for. That materialism is absolutely false. So I could say I'm probably a pretty good Christian. Still working at it every day. Not resting on any laurels here. So I could tell you the Pope's not a good Christian. He's got it backwards. He's a good Marxist is what he is. And that's what a lot of people are applauding. They're saying, hey, I've got a really good Marxist here. Okay, well that's what he is. Fine, be honest about it. I'm not going to debate all the merits of capitalism and Marxism. That's a different issue. We're talking about religion and Christianity here and defining what a good Christian is. That is a super important issue. It's such an important issue. Jesus is back to adjudicate this and he most certainly will. He'll decide who the good Christians are, not the Pope. I hope people are listening to this. It's very important. I'm able to see, you know, keep things where they are. Politics is politics. This is this and this is that. But this issue here is this issue. And I'm able to keep it from being confused. It's very cut and dried. It's very cut and dried. This is a super dangerous situation right now in the world. And thankfully somebody helped and told me about it. Yeah, help comes in strange ways, believe me. The Holy Spirit has a sense of humor. It's not those who you think will tell you, help you out. I get helped by everybody, so I'm very ecumenical towards people. I don't condemn anyone. I'm just saying the Pope is not a good Christian at all. Which is true. Trump's a better Christian than the Pope. So if you want to be a good Christian, feel free to vote your conscience. And don't listen to what the Pope says, okay? Or don't vote at all. It's up to you. May not even be an election this year, actually. They'd rather subvert the entire electoral process than have Trump elected. I guarantee you that. Just like some, let's take reptilians for instance. There may be some reptilians who are better Christians than the Pope because they may be saying, well, you know, maybe I'm not right. Maybe I can change my mind. Maybe I do need to repent. And they will repent at some point too. I mean, the extraterrestrials also repent, believe it or not. They absolutely do. Now, Trump's into glamour. We know that. That's not good. That's not good. But he's someone who could decide, you know what? I see what you're getting at. I gotta change. Keep in mind that people, those who have repented, have been sinners before. Jesus said, I came to save the sinners, not the righteous. The sinners are those who recognize their sin and say, wow, I need to repent. I'm wrong. I've been a sinner. The self-righteous, like the Pope, say, I don't need to repent. Everybody loves me. I'm so righteous. Jesus said the righteous will never get in the kingdom of heaven because they refuse to repent. I say never, meaning as long as they're playing this pretense role of being self-righteous, they will not get into the kingdom of heaven. Of course, ultimately, nobody's left the kingdom of heaven. So there's not a question of getting into it or not getting into it, which the self-righteous can't see it that way. Because they say, no, I must be more qualified than someone else. Well, we never left. We just dream we left. So there's no issue, actually, of getting in or not getting in, which ultimately needs to be seen, which the self-righteous are very heavily defended against seeing that. Very heavily defended against it. So the Pope's putting on a good Marxist show. You know, we'll give him a little golf clap for that. That's as far as it goes, really. He's a fake Christian. Okay, he's a fake Christian. He's a faker. He's a phony. He is a phony. But, you know, Catholics don't always get the popes that they want, right? You might say they get the ones they deserve. Because a lot of Catholicism has gone into the toilet, you know? Absolutely it has. It's a dying religion right now, to tell you the truth. It is a dying religion, and I know about it up close. It's a dying religion. There's still many good Catholics, but the religion itself is dying. That's why it's the last pope. In fact, Jesus is back, so of course it's the last pope. And he's already been deposed, really. Jesus, the Holy Spirit telling us, hey, this isn't a true pope. Don't pay any attention to him. But it's the most misleading pope of all time because of the alliances that he's making and the multimedia and the power and authority that the pope has now is astronomical. And there's a bumper sticker right here in front of me. It says, thank God. Although underneath it has, I think it says Obama 08. Thank God. Maybe that means thank dog. Okay. And well, these people are, this is, thank you for the bumper sticker to get, trigger something. I mean, all these people are saying thank God. I mean, I have these atheists who are saying thank God for this pope. Really? They're blubbering about God. So I really believe in God now. God has finally, you know, gave us a great pope. I'm starting to believe in God. They say, oh, God, the pope is so great, he's converting even the atheists. No, he's agreeing with the atheists. He's agreeing with the atheists. That's why they're saying, thank God. It's hilarious. It's hilarious. He's agreeing in the atheist God, the God of materialism. And they're so relieved, and they're so happy. They say, finally, our utopia is almost here. New World Order, our New World Order utopia is almost here. Well, I'll be in a true utopia, dwelling place that Jesus has fashioned for us. Reduced intensity zone. I'll take that utopia. We get a choice of utopias after all, right? I mean, we get the New World Order utopia or Jesus is a reduced intensity zone utopia. And Jesus isn't the only one that can fashion these. And there may be many Pure Land utopias, reduced intensity zones. Many, 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 many. But we get to choose which type of utopia we want. At least we think we get to choose that. We will choose that. The materialists say, no, there's only one utopia, it's ours. And we get to control you and decide your destiny for you. And we know what a good Christian is and what isn't because the Pope told us. See, we're smart. We're educated. We're smart enough to understand this Pope and where he's coming from. We're smart enough to recognize a good Pope when we see one. Because we've had this good atheistic, secular, humanist education to educate us in materialism. So, of course, and absurdity. So, Of course we're able to recognize one of our own. Ah, the Pope's observed too. Wonderful. Wonderful. So happy now. Dancing in the streets. Thank God, you know, they'll have marches. Thank God for this atheistic Pope. Oh, it's hilarious. If you don't laugh, you gotta cry. I mean, absurdity is quite hilarious. And what else could you do? You can't take it seriously. Jesus says our whole problem is we've took it seriously. We've got to laugh. We forgot to laugh. He wants us to have a good laugh about it. The Holy Spirit wants us to have a good laugh about it. We'll be up there in a reduced intensity zone just telling some pretty funny jokes. I could be sure of that. Keep it smooth. Like I said in the golf game, all the peripherals, all the little stuff, has nothing to do with the game, the swing, hitting the ball. It's what you do when you're not hitting the ball is very important. Like carry the container of sand and grass seed with you when you go to your ball from the cart. Just take it out, carry it with you, because you know you're going to hit a practice swing, right? Maybe two or three. You're going to take up some divots, and when you hit your ball, you're going to take up some sod. So have the bottle of sand and grass seed right with you. Don't first take a swing and then go back to the cart and say, oh gee, I took a divot, I need to go back. Be a professional about it. Say, you know what? See, this is little things like that. Smooth everything out, and then people look at you and say, oh wow, I mean, this someone really knows what they're doing here. It's like home to them. They're so comfortable here. They know how to handle themselves out here. Oh good. I think I'll take some pointers from them. It's funny, I see this sticker on a car. It's that fish symbol of Jesus with inside says Darwin with feet on it, you know. It's like a little fish walking. I should say materialism. It's everywhere. It's the prevailing currents. And again, these trends are going to coalesce. They're going to come together. This is when the trouble will hit really bad. And we don't know what we're in for here. We can speculate it's going to be atrocious. And indeed, Christian eschatology says it will be atrocious. It will be the worst ever. So we have laid out our position very well, except the materialists just absolutely dismiss it. Which is okay. I mean, the fact is that they don't believe in truth doesn't mean you cannot help them out, because they have no choice but to ultimately accept truth. So they might say, well, if you come back at some other time from reduced intensity zone, we won't pay any attention to you. Say, well, you missed out on all this, so you don't know anything. And I say, well, that's nice, but you see that person just died, you know, stand up and walk. And they stand up and walk. And then they'll say, you can't do that. That's against the laws of nature. And they'll say, you see that? That dead flower? Fresh flower now. You see this? And we'll just do all massive miracles, you know. Easy. Piece of cake. Oh, you don't like that? Well, guess what? I just disappeared. Yeah, there's a hologram. We know there's a, you know. So, what could they do? You can still witness to them. They have no choice but to circle back. Just like Longchenpa said, you get the raven who flies on a ship and says, hey, I'm going to take off from this ship. Flies around and around in circles in the ocean, looking. You know, eventually, the raven's got no place to come back to but the ship. So they can brag all they want about how they're never going to listen. We're going to be so materialistic, you'll never be able to change our minds. I say, oh, you know, they'll be singing another tune soon enough for sure. Don't worry about it. I think this is the important faith we need to have, that indeed all those who are seen to be lost and forsaken, they will sing a different tune. They said, yeah, well, I'm not into that jazz any longer. You know that? Change my tastes. I got a right to do that, don't I? Well, of course. So yeah, not so interested in that stuff anymore. Kind of my attention is sort of over here now. I've changed my ways. Oh, you repented? Yeah, I've repented some. Yeah. Oh, okay, good. That's how it works. You cannot remain materialistic too long, unless you really go bad, really go rogue, and then you can delay a little more. No one goes rogue forever. Can't. Cannot do it. The suffering is too terrible. Reversals of fortune, all the struggles, the troubles, oh no, they're unbearable. And all the sex, drugs, and rock and roll in the world won't cure that. Won't cure that toothache, that is for sure. So what do we need? Adamant teachers, miracle workers, all different types of miracles. Some physical miracles are fine to sprinkle in there. There's a lot more subtle miracles, though. Miracles of timing and play of attention. Miracles of play, those are super important. And just again, the Holy Spirit sense of humor. Here I go and I see this big sticker on a rear windshield. Thank God! And I say, oh, wow, that's interesting, that's cool. And then underneath it, there's Obama 208 sticker. This is what it's referring to. It's like, hilarious. Absolutely hilarious. Oh, an atheist has a sense of humor. That's great. I've got to get something here before the rain hits. I was going to ruin it. And this car in front of me is just like going super slow. There's this huge rain cloud about ready to strike. And it's a matter of, seconds. I got it. And this car is just going ultra, ultra slow in front of me. I mean, that's a perfect analogy, is it not, of the world. The materialists are really trying to slow us down, huh? I'm going to make it, though. I'm going to make it here. No thanks to this car. As a matter of fact, just as I arrived, the raindrops start to fall. Isn't that amazing? So they slowed me down almost to the point where it was a problem, but not quite. Here's the thing about materialists. They will, you can be as nice as possible to them. And they'll say, you're very nice, very nice. And they'll say, and we'll be very nice to you as we convert you back to the true religion of materialism. And we will convert you back to it, but we'll be nice about it. History is unequivocal about how materialists operate. And they're very, very fanatical, to say the least. They have no choice, and they're very absurdist. They have no choice. So it doesn't matter. You say, well, I'll just be nice to them. No. They'll be nice to you too, but they'll get their way. Okay. And they'll send you to nice camps where you have nice teachers and you have nice drugs and nice procedures to nicely make sure that you're nicely re-educated so you can nicely fit into their nice idea of absurdity. Just see how nice they are and you decide, well, I'm going to be nice to myself too, and I like my niceness a little better than your niceness. And I'm going to go to a nice place, reduced intensity zone, where I can have really nice help in becoming very adamant about how to nicely help you. And they don't like that too much. No. They say, you can't leave, because we'll have to deal with you later, and we want to cure everybody right now. We don't want to wait for happiness. We can't be happy until all of you are converted to absurdity. Therefore, if you go to somewhere else, this will delay our happiness, because we have to convert everybody to absurdity, of course. Otherwise, reality won't become absurd, will it? So they don't like that at all. They don't like that at all. But that's what it boils down to, doesn't it? That's what it boils down to. Whose niceness are you going to trust? I say, I'll trust the Holy Spirit's niceness. I'll trust non-absurd niceness over absurd niceness. And but thanks for asking. Thanks for offering. And that's when the rubber hits the road. That's when the niceness becomes nastiness. And of course, absurdity says, well, that's the next step. You know, we need to take this next step now. Got to be nasty now because we tried nice. It didn't work. So what happens when nice doesn't work for the materialists? Well, it becomes not so nice. Whereas for those who oriented to truth, they're always nice, actually, because they know that nice will work and they can be converted, that truth will win out. So they're compassionate, patient and compassionate. Truth will win out. Ultimately, absolutely. There's zero question about that, zero doubt. But the materialists are very jumpy, very jittery. They feel like if we don't do this quickly, you know, we might completely lose. You know, so we gotta force the issue here. What else can we do, you know? Yeah, it's funny. It's good to laugh at now, and we've got to make sure we can keep laughing at it. Laughing, right? Absolutely, we do. Got to keep our sense of humor. Don't want to lose that. So, got to make sure that we are safe and sound and can have a good laugh at all of this. Keep laughing. Put it in real simple terms, we can say that very soon it will be the crime, an absolute crime, to be non-absurdist. What's the crime? Crime against absurdity. Crime against absurdity. So, from their eyes, God is the ultimate criminal. From the standpoint of absurdist standpoint, God is the ultimate criminal. But they say, guess what? God will let you off, or will let you off easy. You can change the way you are. You can change, and you're no longer God, but we'll still. You can keep the honorific title, you know, because they're nice. The observers are very nice. You can keep the honorific title. We'll call you God, but we all know you're not really God anymore. You know, you changed for the better. You're now an absurdist too. You joined us because, after all, we're greater than you, and you really didn't have any choice but to join us. So. This is what is literally going to happen here, is absurdity will rule the roost, and non-absurdists, realists, will be branded as arch criminals. We're tacitly already there. It's just that the teeth haven't clamped shut. I mean, we're in the shark's mouth, right? That's not a good place to be, in a shark's mouth. A great white shark's mouth, no. And the jaws are closing quickly. So we might still be thinking, everything's okay. But then I say, what are those pearly whites I'm seeing? It's, kind of looks sharp. What is that? Oh, it's jaws coming down. And you say, uh-oh, that's not good. Get me out of here, Jesus. Yeah. Jesus knows how to get us out of here. Someone who raised himself from the dead and turned his body into clear light, we call it ascension, turned into light. Many Tibetan Buddhist masters have done that. Some call it the rainbow body, but they're able to just turn themselves into clear light. No body. Some leave nails and hair, others nothing. Nothing. Some leave relics. Longchenpa was going to dissolve his body into pure light, and he was approached by some ancient spiritual masters who requested that he not do that, and that he do some really big teaching at the end there, and they wanted him to die according to absurdist way. So he did that way. But then when they burned his body, there was instead of his ashes, there were massive amounts of relics. His body turned into all these relics. This is something that the Tibetans have witnessed many, many, many times, along with the rainbow body. There are Tibetans alive right now, Tibetan Buddhists, who have seen this happen with their teacher. So, Jesus simply turned his body into clear light, because the body's just an appearance of light. That's all it is. Everything's just an appearance of light. So Jesus can certainly take us to his dwelling place. Poof, easy for him. Let him take care of that. It's not a bother with us. I mean, he desires that it's so. We do not object, and it is so. It's that simple. For everyone, if they want to avail themselves of that opportunity, instead of staying in Absurdistville. Yeah. So we're whittling it down here, boiling it down. And of course, there are some who say, no, we'll be nice, you know, but let's be nice, you know. Those are called appeasers. Appeasing materialists, you know, is like trying to appease Hitler. How well did that work out? Well, Hitler played a great game up until he stopped playing a great game, a nice game, right? So I'm a nice guy. I'm a very reasonable guy. You can get along with me. Let's make some deals. So he made deals with everybody. Did he keep any of them? No. And he'd say, well, that's absurd to keep that, you know, I do what I want, okay. So, the idea of appeasing materialism is a very, very bad step. Very bad. Cannot do that. The smart Jews got out of Germany. They said, hey, we've seen this before. We've seen this before. We're not going to be fooled by, say, oh, don't worry, you know, we'll be nice, you know. Says the crocodile, you know, says the shark. Don't worry. I'm a nice shark. I won't bite meanly. I'll bite cleanly. When they say they're going to be nice, that means they'll make a nice clean bite. Not a gashy, you know, sloppy bite. This is a real nice, quick and merciful. Oh, that's so nice of them. So appeasement is folly. It is folly. Absurdity doesn't have anywhere to go except repentance or doubling down on absurdity. That's it. And if they don't repent, they're going to double down on absurdity. There's no two ways about it. And if they repent, then they're not calling the tune for you. They're humble, and they're paying attention, they're listening, and they're starting to feel the wow. Full stop in the wow. Quiet. Be able to be quiet. Sobering up. So, you know, it's quite a program to sober up from absurdity. It's the worst addiction there is. It's the worst addiction there is absurdity. And, you know, it branches out to all these other addictions. And we keep treating these other addictions. We never treat absurdity here. This world never gets around. Well, the great teachers do. But materialism never gets around to treating absurdity. That's their premise. Of course, they say premises don't matter. Well, if the premises don't matter, why don't we then just treat absurdity? Why would that matter to them? But they say, no, can't treat that. Well, I say, wait a minute, you just said premises don't matter. So why not change the premise there? And you say it doesn't matter, so why would you object to that? They've just been caught in a snare there, haven't they? Wow. That's quite an interesting observation. Now, the non-absurdist says absolutely premises matter. Totally. So we got to focus on the premise. They say premises don't matter at all. Cause and effect are separate. So they say we don't have to focus on it at all. It doesn't matter. I say great. So since it doesn't matter, it shouldn't matter at all that if you change the premise, right? So there shouldn't be any resistance there either. Uh-oh. Yeah. That's when the teeth start chomping. Yep, fiat currency is about to get dumped, for sure. About to get dumped. They don't want another repeat of Greece, believe me. I'm sure that the EU is working on that one. Well, let's dump it all and do it all electronically. No more tax cheating Greeks, you know, and no more of this debt. We're going to absolutely put the hammer down on that fiat currency and all of that. But if you vote for us and empower what we can do, we'll let you have kind of a welfare black market. You know, we won't really police that too much. It's crony socialism, right? Absolutely. You can change from capitalism to socialism, but you can never take the cronyism out of any ism. Still got the ism there, and it's cronyism. And I don't know what part of that they don't understand. Maybe well, they don't want to understand it. Oh boy. Trying to rain today, just can't quite do it. There's a car just there in front of me, didn't know what it was doing, kind of wandering here, kind of slowing down on the side of the road. And I said, okay, they're trying to find some place. Uncertain. I said, probably an elderly driver. So that's fine, it's great. Nice, be nice and patient. No trouble at all. And I was right, I passed him. It's an elderly white male who's, he finally found the place he was going to. He just, you know, uncertain, I'm not really sure. But he never just stopped in the road, just stopped or you know, just did crazy stuff. So you can kind of feel the difference, you know. You really can with drivers. Like, okay, is this somebody who's just, you know, really a dangerous, doesn't know how to drive here? Or is it somebody who's just a little elderly or older? Sometimes elderly people go real slow on the freeway. And just say, okay, that's good. You're in the slow lane. You're going slow. Stay safe. It's the ones that are in the fast lane and suddenly stop, you know, and say, wait a minute, did I just go past my exit? Stop. How do I get back there? Let me see, can I cut over? Actually, driving has improved a little bit here. People are a little less frantic. I'm not seeing so many people frantically cutting over when they're missing their exits on the freeway, where they'll cut over four lanes, like basically make a right angle and nearly flip their car, and will like miss your bumper by a foot, and miss ramming into some concrete barrier by a foot at 80 miles an hour, just so they can make an exit. You know, this is the pressure they're under at work, this society. I just haven't seen that recently. For a while now, haven't seen it happen. Whereas before, I saw it every day. So, I think people are calming down a little bit here. They're moving back from the brink of just completely flipping out.
That's helpful.
I don't know. I guess that comment of the Pope, I don't know what, I don't know when it was made. I really have no idea. But I walked into some place and that's a, you know, radio water sub. They're talking about it's like super big news or something. I don't know. Well, you'd think it'd be big news. I mean, that's outrageous. Comment, absolutely outrageous comment. Whatever, you know, it just seems. Stay away from that, except just to make the final comments that I have made previously. You know, I think Trump's a better Christian than the Pope, for sure. No question about it. So, I think that should just settle the whole thing right there. Put it to bed, and let's focus in on this absurdist coup d'etat that is about ready to happen in this world. That Pope statement is part of the coup. All right, the whole thing, Trump is, the whole thing about him is he's willing to talk back to anybody. Well, just had an interaction with a Christian there. pointing out the troubles that the apostles had. He said, you think you have it tough? What about St. Paul? I mean, where does it but in all fairness to us now, the adversary is much trickier, much cleverer, much more diabolical. Okay, then they just, you know, they're out for you to chop your head off, you know. And now, they're after your spirit, they're after your belief, they're after, you know, and they're very clever and sneaky about it. So, I would really say it's tougher now. You know, there was more graphic, right? But no, now it is so sly. The snake is really out for the kill right now. The python is trying to strangle us all. Python of absurdity. And he was given some very good witnessing there. You know, God is more alive than ever. That's right. And they think they can. Terrorists think they can change anything. They can't. They think they can change God. This is the entire root of our problem. We think we can change reality. This is the root of our problem, and we can't. And yet we say, but what do we do with all this absurdity? You know, it all seems such like an amazing system that we have developed here. That's part of the continuity fear. Part of the continuity fear. Make the shift. In reality, there's no continuity fear. So the shift is it. This is it. It's done. Just like that. It's accomplished. As he said, the intensity now is so strong. And it's funny. I saw this book lying upside down. I picked it up. It said Firestorm was the name of the book. Firestorm. I looked through it a little bit. It says, you know, the firestorm is coming. Are you ready? The firestorm is now ideological, right? More than anything. And I believe what this Pope... Well, I don't know his name. I got to look up his name. I've forgotten what it is. Cardinal something. He's not the Pope. He's a cardinal. Cardinal Sin. He used to be in the Philippines, the chief cardinal there was named Cardinal Sin. And they said it was a very good name for him, actually. Cardinal Sin. No, not kidding. Oh, no. So, I mean, I don't know what his name is. The cardinal from Argentina, was it? I think it's Argentina. Yeah. He started a firestorm here. I mean, this is a firestorm. Apparently. I don't know. We're finished with it in terms of, you know, again, just... But this is what we want to avoid, is these firestorms. We want to have good humor and just, you know, move it on down the road here. We don't get stuck in this stuff. This is what I've been preaching and preaching and preaching and preaching. And I have to keep saying it because I believe that the people are not picking up on it yet. You don't get stuck in these firestorms. And I'm giving you the tools to use to get free of these easily. To say, well, you know what? I think, Trump's a lot better Christian than this cardinal such and such. I'll tell you that. And then that's it. That just diffused the whole thing. What can they say? Firestorm's over. What does that cardinal know about Christianity, really? I mean, Jesuits worship Virgin Mary. You know, that's who they're fighting for. Goddess worship. They're fighting for her program, the goddess's program. And what a slander on the Virgin Mary, isn't it? This whole worshiping of the Virgin Mary is an absolute slander on the real Virgin Mary, who I'm sure is a fabulous saint. You would think so. Yeah, I can't say I'm sure. It wouldn't be surprising if she's a fabulous saint. One of the victorious ones. But to use her as a figurehead for this false doctrine, false church, absurdism, to use her as the figurehead of absurdism is really a slander upon her, a hideous slander. Quite a burden to bear, huh? Quite a burden to bear. And so the Jesuits are in service to the Virgin Mary. There's no question about it. And this Pope is too. No question about it. they're good at doing lip service to Jesus, and you don't hear much about the Holy Spirit at all because they're not listening to the Holy Spirit. So why would they say anything? Perfunctory stuff. Perfunctory. So we'll see what the next amazing grace is. And again, my prayers are amazing grace for everyone. Amazing grace for everyone. Stuff that like pins you to the back of your seat kind of grace. The wow grace is what I pray for everyone. Everyone. Without exception. The wow grace. I love that feeling where you just feel like somehow you're pinned to the back of your seat. Wow. Like G-force is hitting you. It is. It's grace force that's hitting you. But it feels like some sort of G-force is hitting you. So just give prayers for G-force grace to come hit everyone. Just hit him like that. Non-stop. We've got no time for non-grace at this point. We have no more moments. The coup d'etat is coming very soon. The absurdist coup d'etat is coming very soon in this world. And the Pope just let the cat out of the bag, or the ex-Pope, the Cardinal such and such, just let the cat out of the bag. And people are starting to say, uh-oh, you know, this is trouble. This is trouble. I wonder if he thinks that Bernie and Hillary are really good Christians, you know? Oh, yeah. So the cat is out of the bag. And we should be saying, uh-oh. But here it's like, yeah. Okay, come on, Grace. Let's have the G-force, G-shock, you know. Let's have the G-shock right now. Right now. We need the G-shock right now. Hallelujah. And we need it. So we need a big one. I guess the Pope really started a firestorm. So we need a big one right now. All right? Real big one. One big one coming up. It's like at a burger place. I'll have the big one. All right. Got the big one coming up. I miss the burger places, you know. I haven't had a burger in a long time. Had to stop the burgers. I eat a veggie burger, but it tastes so much like meat. It's like eating a burger. I can't get the buns anymore for it. I have to special order them. The doggone store we got them from, we just stopped carrying them because they were so popular. Nobody bought their own brand, so they said we got to stop carrying this because it's kind of like materialists say, well, we want everyone to buy into our brand. We can't have the Christians around or the spiritually wise ones around because everybody will want to buy into that. We can't have any miracles around. People want to, so they, we want them to buy our brand. So we're gonna not just carry it anymore. I stopped eating hamburgers because their buns are terrible. It's tough to get a good hamburger bun. It's like almost nirvana when you find a really good one. A challah. You gotta get a challah hamburger bun. It doesn't fall apart. You can put every kind of condiment on it you want and it stays nice and firm. It doesn't get all waterlogged and soggy and crumbly and falling apart. And even to the last bite, it doesn't fall apart. You just melt all that cheese and throw all the relish and mustard and ketchup and pickles and onions and hot peppers and Tabasco sauce and lettuce, tomatoes, just the whole schmear. And these buns just handle it no trouble. But, you know, that puts some calories on you. Put some calories on you. So I have not eaten a hamburger in, oh my gosh, maybe, I don't know, how long has it been? 7-8 months or so? Something like that? Miss the burger. I mean, that was, we used to eat, I mean, growing up, you eat burgers. It's just, go to a burger place. Charbroiled burgers with fries and a milkshake. It kind of makes you feel like life is good. I can have a burger. Very messy, too. It's nice. You just grab it with both hands and chomp down on it. I mean, you don't have to eat all civilized with a burger. I don't know too many people go at a burger with a knife and fork. Or a hot dog. Oh, man, that's like... Must be getting hungry here. Well, hungry for some G-Shock here. G-Shock Grace. G-Force Grace here. We're looking for some G-Force Grace, so heads up for it. Heck, you know, keep your heads up here. It's likely to be very potent now. And we have done a good job preparing for it, but it'll still floor us, I'm sure. Time to get floored. Really time to get floored. Sometimes the great saints, all sorts of miracles occur around the great saints. All sorts of miracles. Natural phenomena for truth. For the materialist, they claim it's supernatural. No, it's actually natural. It's this pretense, which is just pretend natural. Actually, it's just non-pretend natural. Flowers, just, it starts raining flowers from the sky. Flower petals, too. Just flowers and flower petals just coming down from the sky like rain, and just sometimes massive amounts. That's a nice one. I'd like to be able to do that on call. You know, just let's just have a rain of flower petals. Beautiful. I'm sure it's quite beautiful seeing all these flower petals come raining down from the sky. Rivers, it'd be nice to see rivers just made of flower petals, you know. Just the yeah, beautiful. Are you kidding? They do that with the Ganges sometimes, trying to get a lot of flowers in there, but it's not a, I mean, a whole river is just flowers. Rivers of anything. You can have rivers of anything, actually. So maybe we can have some flowers come down from the sky, you know? Why not? Let's say, hey, Jesus, let us know you're here. You know, let's start doing some miracles. Why not? I mean, we got to build on the momentum that the apostles did. The apostles did so much to the martyrs for all of us. So much. So let's build, you know, let's build on their success, what they gave for us, that legacy. Let's not let that legacy down. Let's not let it down. But let's get a modern legacy going right here. A modern legacy. Not the yoga girl tights spandex legacy. That's a different kind of legacy. Let's get a real miraculous legacy going here. Let's get it going now. A lot of time on the road today, a lot of time to reflect, and it was brought to mind someone whose mother's very sick, Alzheimer's, cancer, it just is the whole thing, and I just thinking, okay, prayers for that blessed spirit who shares the one mind with us. You see, we all share the one mind, the same mind. We're all of one mind, actually. We're all one spiritual family of one mind. So we say to them, be assured that we are not fooled in the slightest bit over any appearance of the flesh. It means absolutely nothing as to your true nature. Keep this always in mind, and may infinite rays of soft, clear light ceaselessly rain down their grace upon your mind without ending. every ray being a blessing of God. And so may your mind be absolutely blessed by all these rays of blessings from God. And we know that is your true nature. And the flesh has absolutely nothing to do with what we are, with what you are. Death, again, has nothing to do. We don't die at all. Death cannot touch us. So again, rest assured that you are, that we know the truth about you. See? And we thank the truth, the facts of truth, being brought to our attention by the Holy Spirit, by Jesus Christ, by all the great teachers, all the great sages and saints, and all those who have shifted their perception, their perspective, to recognize the truth as it is, and are no longer fooled by absurdity. All the wonderful non-absurdists who know that we share the one mind. We all share the same one mind. So this is a different type of thing than groveling before God. Says, God, please take away the terrible sin. I know I've been such a terrible sinner. I got you punishing me with this cancer and this stuff. I just please. I don't want to die. That's not. Affirm the truth of our being is the way to pray. Affirm the truth of our being. That's the right way to pray. And Christian Science is one of the great testimonies to this. They got it right. They had it right. They're being outlawed now, basically. Forced vaccinations for your children. It's like a no-brainer. Of course you got to vaccinate the children for everything possible. And even, you know, stuff that's not even yet here. Let's say, oh, we came with a vaccine and this is, you know, might be useful someday. Let's make sure you got all this stuff. Maybe this is like a super vaccine. And just cure stuff you don't even know about. Anyway, we could say that anybody supports the Pope's agenda is a lousy Christian. You know, we could say that too, couldn't we? And maybe we are saying that. Anyone who supports the Marxist-Leninist liberation theology, secular, humanistic, Virgin Mary worshiping agenda is not a good Christian at all. And in fact, they're not. If they support that, they're not. Everything we know but now about Jesus points in the right, true direction. And of course, in miracles, made very clear what Jesus stands for. I mean, you talk about Jesus putting his neck on the line. I mean, he said, this is what I really stand for. And a lot of mistakes have been made along the way, and I expected that. And he's, you know, a lot of Christians might look at him and say, hey, you're not my Jesus. And he said, well, I'm the real Jesus. So maybe you need to choose again, reevaluate. So he already came out and said, this is what I really stand for. Let me make it absolutely abundantly clear what my gospel really is, because there's been a lot of tampering with it. A lot of egoic, a lot of absurdist, you know, ideology has infiltrated it. So he says, I want to clear it all up. I want to clear it all up. And he certainly did. For those who had the ears and eye, you know, to hear it and the eyes to see it. So we know who a good Christian is now at this point, right? Even Jesus made it very clear, this is what a good Christian really is. So Pope cannot pull the wool over, well, the cardinal such and such cannot pull the wool over our eyes. Okay, too late for that, sir. Too late for that, my brother in Christ, the one mind, brother in Christ, the one mind, the smoothed out, non-preferential, pure spaciousness, God mind that we all have access to, that is infinitely creative, inherently, effortlessly, infinitely creative. We all have equal access to that one mind. We're all joined together as one in that one mind. That's the true body of Christ. And we're all inherently that way. There's no way we never fell away from it. We never abandoned it. We never did anything to it. We've always been absolutely, inherently submerged in it. Everyone. There is no other mind. So there's nothing else can ever come about from a non-existent mind. So everything that arises is from the one mind. There's no way around it. Everything is from God. Even the bad Christians are from God, right? That's right. So, you know, this cardinal is toying with... He doesn't know. He's in over his head, actually. He's in over his head. He doesn't realize that Jesus has raised up some pretty feisty and clear-minded apostles, latter-day apostles. And they are not fooled one bit by this. Great apostasy, right? Yeah, the black pope, the final pope, the black pope, the anti-pope. Malachi's prophecy is looking pretty strong, right? Looking very strong. Very strong. Maybe it's, you know, a little favor for the POTUS. The POTUS and the Pope getting in bed together. Maybe they'll be married someday. And they're doing, you know, I scratch, you know, you scratch my back, I'll scratch your back. The president said, I'll go along with global warming if you just KO Trump. Pope says, hey, done deal, not a problem. We're all on the same side after all, aren't we? Yeah. Side of Marxism. Absolutely. Godless, atheistic ideology. Birds of a feather flock together. A couple of posers. They get along well. Must have gone to the same acting lessons instructor, the ego, Lucifer. Took acting lessons from Lucifer. What's really the continuity fear? They've got good acting lessons from continuity fear. Which we all have, but we're trying to, you know, shed those, get rid of those, evaporate them. Rest naturally disposed, naturally disposed. So, well, the great miracle that we're looking for now, I think we should herald the imminent arrival of a great miracle at this point. Really, we should. It's good for the goose, it's good for the gander here. Come on. If you're going to start, well... Yeah, that's a good slip of the tongue there. You're going to start this type of firestorm? Well, you know what? Firestorms draw firemen, don't they? Put out the fire. We'll see what kind of firemen show up to put out this firestorm in the minds of all apostles and Christians and ascenders. And non-absurdists everywhere. A non-absurdist is a non-absurdist by any other name. Okay, so we're very ecumenical here. Absolutely. So non-absurdists get along beautifully together. I get along beautifully with Longchenpa. He's a superb non-absurdist. A superb par excellence non-absurdist par excellence. So I love it. I love it. I get along super. There's no compatibility issues there at all. And that's what's important. Birds of a feather do flock together. So rounding out the recording here, I got home and I was able to reference what the Pope said, Cardinal Bergoglio, actually, Cardinal Bergoglio. Pretty interesting. It's actually worse than I thought. He didn't specifically say that those who vote for Trump are not being good Christians. He says that if Trump said what he said, well, of course he said what he said. What do you mean if he said it? What a weasel, you know. He says it without saying it, so to speak. You know, if he said what he has said, then he's not a Christian. He didn't say he's not a good Christian. He said even worse. He said he's not a Christian, period. That's even worse. And then they asked him, are you telling people how to vote? And he says, well, you know, I'm not going to get into that. What do you mean you're not going to get into it? You just did. Unbelievable. The Jesuitry in the sophistry in this Cardinal Bergoglio's mind is really something else. And then people say, are you a meddler and, you know, a pawn? And he says, well, you know, maybe I am. Maybe, you know, I'll just leave it up to other people to decide that. Well, so he doesn't deny it really at all, right? And he made some other comment. 1 minute. Oh, okay. Trump called him a politician. And then he laughed and said, that's great, because Aristotle labeled politicians as animus politicus or something like that, which means human animal. And he says, that's very reassuring. That's great, because I certainly am a human person. Wow. You talk about blasphemy. You talk about blasphemy. That's the heart of it. I mean, that's his Jesus says in Journey Beyond Words, which is a teaching aid to A Course in Miracles, that we should start every prayer, every session, every spiritual focus, we should start with saying, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. He said, this is absolutely crucial. We are not bodies, we are not human beings, we are not human persons at all. And this is what he came to liberate us from, this delusion. And the Pope is insisting and takes great delight in saying that he's a human person, essentially a human animal, animus politicus, something like that. Aristotle, you know, it's Latin, I guess. This is extraordinary. So, I mean, he's showing his stripes more and more and more and more. You know, if we don't understand what type of mindset this is by now, then we're awfully deluded ourselves. Holy cow. Trump's right. He is a politician. There is no question about it. He's just a closet politician, tried to get away with it. But he's absolutely a politician. And pandering, you know, in the worst sort of ways. And so there you have it. Trump is a better Christian than Cardinal Bergoglio. Okay, there you have it. And we'll just leave it at that. And why do we say that? Well, Trump's not pretending to be a great Christian, or the Pope is. So who's the deceiver? And isn't being a deceiver the Antichrist? Yeah, I mean, if you ask Trump, say, are you a good Christian? He'd probably say, not really. I'm not really that great of a Christian, though. Okay, so what is he being? He's being honest. Right? He says, I probably have a lot of work I need to do on this. You know, I could be a lot better, that is for sure. Honest. Okay. Pope, well, obviously he thinks he's a fabulous Christian. And he's not. So who is being the big deceiver here? So anyway, moving on from that, and we're looking for great, huge miracles, which, expect them now. Expect huge miracles, and they're coming every day. I just had a tremendous one last evening of being able to visualize all the blessings of God just shining out in all directions and visualize like planets and universes spread out throughout space, all shining out infinite blessings everywhere. You know, it was just very profound, abstract ability now to see the blessings of God in this unrestricted, continual flow, without break, without any cessation, eternally flowing these blessings, never-ending blessings upon us, upon the spiritual family of the one mind, which is what we really are. And this human animal is a mere fake pretense. Spirit simply pretending it's something that it's not. That's all it is. And Jesus came to make that abundantly clear. And the Cardinal Bergoglio is taking great delight in announcing to the world his solidarity with the belief that he's a human animal, a human person, human animal. Wow. You can't get more off track than that. That is extraordinarily off track. So, you know, he's a saboteur. Plain and simple. He's a saboteur. He's trying to divert Christians off track. And that is the very definition of a saboteur. It's the worst type of saboteur. Those who attempt to divert Christians from the real truth of Jesus' gospel are saboteurs. The worst kind. The worst kind. And Trump is certainly not of that ilk at all. You know, he's a straight shooter. He says, here's my flaws. Here's what I am. I mean, either you don't like me or don't like me, but I'm not, you know, I'm just a... So, you know, here's the warts. He's not trying to carry out this massive deception, massive derailment of spiritual, right spiritual focus. So, as the world turns, the more things change, the more they stay the same. It's the same kind of problems that have always faced the world. It gets pretty boring, doesn't it? So, let us find all the blessings of God upon us, the ceaseless blessings and all the wonderful characteristics and qualities that constitute God, the endless, infinite qualities. Let them all stream into everyone's mind right this moment, right now. Amen and amen.